Oh, who's that?
Comedy
Quick,
police.
Go get that. Could be somebody scary. I don't know.
Get the knife.
Yeah, Kevin's going to get it. Someone's knocking at Fitzdog Studios at the back door. Kevin, our producer, is going to answer it. Who is it? Holy shit. Norm Macdonald is now walking into Fitzdog Studios.
Should I get up?
That can't be.
Is that even true?
I don't think they can make that
up. I don't think that's true.
I talked to him earlier today. He knew I was coming here.
Seriously? Hey!
Look at this.
Look at this.
Holy shit.
Unbelievable.
Let me get up real quick. Hey, Norm.
This is when podcasting really...
Yeah.
How are you, man?
Norm, sit down, brother.
Good to see you.
And Ben Hoffman and Lori Jo Hoekstra.
How are you? This is incredible. This is it's heart stopping podcasting here. I live again. When you live in Venice Beach, we once had Natalie Maines on a podcast, and Zach Galifianakis walked in to use my printer. This tops that because Mark McGrath.
Mark, sit down.
Is sitting here. Norm, have a seat. All right, Mark, you sit.
Well,
I'm going to share.
I'm going to share a mic with Norm. How about that?
Down,
we don't even need these.
No. Here's what I would like. Here's what we're going to do on Fitzdog Radio. Norm Macdonald is now going to interview Mark McGrath instead of me because you know what? Yeah. I almost feel like you're a better interviewer than an interviewee.
You're out of questions?
And, and I'm completely out of questions. By the way, I'm going to be performing at the Cleveland Hilarities, if you could read it. Cleveland Hilarities, October...
What is going on?
No, your intuition about me being a good interviewer is really bad. Ben Hoffman, you want to
I'll feed you questions.
Ben Hoffman is going to pitch a TV show tomorrow.
No shit.
Yeah, to Comedy Central.
Not tomorrow.
Or Friday.
Would you give him any warning on that? No, I know it inside and out. Thanks.
Ben wrote on Sports Show with Norm Macdonald.
Yeah.
Did a great job, so Norm knows him well.
Take your headphones off, dummy. There's nothing to hear.
I just like to hear the ambience, man. It makes me feel good.
We were talking earlier about whether or not anybody can really change their worldview. Because Mark is this guy who, you know, when you meet a nice guy, you like to poke a little bit and find the ugly side because you think the guy's full of shit, right? I do, and I can't find his dark side.
I'm super happy when I meet people like that. To tell you the truth, like I'm not a cynical person.
That's what amazes me about you because I think because you're edgy and because you take on people that are probably deserving of a good barb now and again, that maybe you're mean spirited, but you're actually not.
No, but what's Mark's worldview?
Well, Mark, why don't you answer that?
No, we were saying...
My guess would be like he's a person that seems to be full of goodwill.
And he's super positive, and I was asking if it was always that way. And he said, yeah, and Greg then had the thesis, you're born that way. And I thought maybe a lot of people have bottomed out or were negative. Find a way, whether it's a therapist or a book or whatever it is, a bottom, and then they get positive and they start like... Because this guy is so ridiculously positive in a good way. I'm not making fun of it at all. I'm wondering if he was always that way because I'm always trying to learn how to be positive. And it's tough, I find.
I kind of told them that like I feel like I'm the most fortunate guy in the world. I mean, I overpaid and was fairly successful. Two things I don't do well, sing and host. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I'm sitting here at the table with you guys.
Norm agreed,
I feel like I'm
stronger.
Where's Waldo? I don't really belong here, you know? So I think that just sort of like perpetuates my positivity if there is any to be had, you know? If that makes any sense.
That doesn't make sense.
You don't need a comment either, Norm. I'm just kind
well,
of
this is what
you know.
I think. I think, like, this is the thing I came up with. You want to hear it?
Yeah.
Yes.
Everybody has dealt a hand of cards, right? Everybody's dealt their own hand in life. And so then you go, well, can people rise up above their position where they start when they're poor and get rich and get out of a troubled place? Because they're dealt this hand, but also part of the hand you're dealt is being able to overcome adversity. That's also part of the hand you're dealt.
But I think adversity is one thing, but I read once that, say you suffered the loss of a sibling, that you would be depressed. Anybody would obviously be distraught. It's traumatic. But that within a year, these studies they did, There was this Harvard professor, did a lot of actually nuts and bolts. These were, you know, scientific studies of brain levels that they can chart now. And they found that people with a positive disposition return to it no matter what adverse they've been through. People that hit the lottery but were always sort of cynical, they go back to that within a year. So that it may not be a matter that you can dig into, like financially, your well-being, as much as something that you struggle with but can only, I don't know, maybe there's a little bit of sway but not a fundamental change.
But I don't think, like, let's, like, I see people on TV and shit, right? And they're like, you never, like, when your child dies, you never get over it. It's always the same. Every day you fucking think about it. Not a fucking hour passes. And I'm like, horse shit. You know? And then you see the guy interviewed for the rest of the thing. He's laughing.
Yeah.
I swear I seen Paul Newman do that once on Larry King. He's like, you think about it all the time. Then he's laughing, telling a story about some other shit.
Yeah, yeah.
Of course you don't think about it all the time, or you'd put a gun in your head.
Right. Right?
Could you read this?
Oh, yeah. Oh, your stand-up. Yeah, you're going to be at the Chicago Improv. They have an improv in Chicago?
No.
I go to that fucking Zany's. Holds 50 people.
Oh,
I know. And then they go, it's an institution. You go, what? No one can hear you. It's like horrible. Yeah, I know. Right. You go, what am I, a fucking historian? I'm Mark Maron all of a sudden? I'm just trying to make a living. Pittsburgh, the improv in Pittsburgh, that's a good gig.
Yeah.
And your September, your stand-up live, where was that?
In Phoenix.
Oh, I did that. Oh, fuck, yeah.
Huh?
Well, here's the thing. Did you used to do Tempe?
Yes.
Yeah, well, they convinced me to change from Tempe to Stand Up Live.
Yeah.
But Tempe was the best room in the country.
It was the best room in the country, but I guess now they book it like corporate. They want everybody to be clean.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Is that Spade's territory? Oh. The Tempe one? Does he do that a lot?
The last time I did Tempe, Spade flew in on a private jet.
Really?
It was me and Artie Lang at the Tempe Improv, and Spade, and Artie goes, we're out to dinner. He goes, Spade might be coming out. I go, well, why is he in town? He's going to be in about 5 minutes. He fucking shows up in a jet, watches the show. We go out for a drink, and then he flies home.
One time this limo driver is driving me, right? And he's like, I got to tell you right off the bat, I'm a character.
He has to tell you?
Yeah, I'm like, you can't say it yourself.
It's on his card in quotes underneath his name.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. No, that's like the guy who you hear go, but you know me.
Yeah.
Yeah. Of course.
Right.
Naturally, you're a character.
My favorite is like when a guy just, he's a motherfucker, and then, but is that people just say his name, and that excuses everything. That's Sam.
That's Sam.
Yeah. You're like, what? The guy's fucking mean and shit. Yeah, you got no Sam.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
He's a mean guy.
That's OJ.
He's just Sam-ing you. Oh, you got Sam.
Well, I guess maybe that was Josh. Maybe Josh was a liar. You know? And he became a verb. He's joshing you. He's lying to you.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah,
wow.
Yeah.
Dick.
Actually, it came from Josh Billings, the American humorist, but it's a good theory.
You know what would be the worst insult?
That should be sponsored.
That was
a little factoid. Like,
yeah, I know.
If you talk about the lowest thing in comedy, it's being called a humorist, by the way.
It is, right?
It is the worst thing to be called.
Well, you know, like, what do you think of the
Dave
author,
Barry?
David Sedaris.
I love David Sedaris.
Is Andy Rooney a humorist?
Yes.
Got it. You'd be right.
I think they're very often self-named.
But, you know, I remember reading an article in Spy one time. Remember that magazine from a long time ago?
Separated
Birth. Seinfeld, they had Seinfeld quotes and Andy Rooney quotes all in the mixed up, but you couldn't tell.
That's funny.
It's pretty interesting.
Wow.
Yeah. Now, I actually love... I'm not saying I dislike Andy Rooney. I'm saying that personally, if I were called a humorist, I would take it as an insult because it has a soft connotation to it.
It's an old school term, isn't it? They're like humorous. You know, people say
out to
be humorous.
It's kind of it means
their
that
thoughts.
Yeah, it's like being called a thespian instead of a good actor.
I picture a bow tie.
And if you got to write a big long fucking thing in the newspaper, hundreds of words a day and shit, it's not going to be too good. But when, like, because when I was a kid, it was Art Buchwald.
I love Art Buchwald.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. But I didn't. You love? I didn't understand it that much.
I like political comedy. I just liked.
But it was very like one idea stretched out. Right? I guess it was a satire or something, right? I didn't understand a fucking word of it.
My dad liked him, and I used to read the craziest shit because my parents would anything that had comedy in it when I was a kid. I was into, and like I just knew that Art Buchwald. And so I met him once with your buddy Jack Stout.
Oh, really?
He had a buddy who lived on the vineyard that I sponged onto and became friends with. And I'm standing on the beach one night, and. And Art Buchwald standing there. He dresses like a fucking lunatic. You know, he's got silly hat and the silly, you know, everything's buttoned wrong on purpose. and he was funny as shit. He was like cursing about the Kennedys and they were standing right down the beach. It was like this very she part of Martha's Vineyard. And I just remember reading all these shitty books like Irma Bombeck. She was a humorist.
She was a humorist, yeah. Irma Bombeck. Her book was called The Grass is Always Greener on Top of a Septic Tank.
That's right. Or the other one was, If Life is a Bowl of Cherries, Why Am I Always in the Pits?
Yes. Oh, yeah.
That was another one.
These are like things you knit on pillows.
Yes. Yeah. I wonder, I guess because when you wake up, like, you want to just laugh.
Well, who's a young humorist today? Excuse me, Mike.
I thought it was David Sedaris.
Oh, Sedaris. Oh, okay.
Who I don't know at all.
I don't either.
But you like him.
I enjoy him quite a bit.
Yeah. So you like humorists.
What about Louis Black?
He's a political satirist.
He's angry.
Is he a little bit on the cusp of a humorist at all?
Oh, man, that guy's angry.
Yeah, he is, man. That's all I got.
What does it take to tee him off?
Anything. This is the problem. These guys that are angry, they get fucking caught in a corner because there's only so much shit you can get angry about. So then I'm watching, you see Dennis Leary or something. He's like, fucking croissants. I don't want a fucking croissant. You're like, okay, that's all right. Why can't you just call it a donut? I don't know. It's not really a donut.
Because it's a different version of that.
But yeah, you know, when you're right, you gotta go to that point of view. But he's a lot of spit comes out of him, Louis Black. But he's a political. I don't know if he's a satirist, really.
Well, I think when it's politics, people default to satirist for some
reason.
Yeah,
yeah.
Whereas satire, I think technically means that you're taking something on, but you're going to the core of it.
Yeah, you're saying the truth. Yeah, right. You're something. It's really bad. I remember at Saturday Night Live, Jim Downey. He would describe Janine Garofalo. He'd go, "How did she become an expert on comedy? Because where the fuck's her jokes? You know, like don't you have to have one quotable joke in your life? You know." And then he said, in his generation, or Janine Garofalo, in his generation was Alan King. He just fucking. A bunch of all his shit, but he'd talk about comedy.
Yes.
He'd have, you know, shows about comedy.
And he had a series Inside the Comedy Mind.
Did he really?
Where, yeah, he would sit on a stool, and then he'd make like a Jerry Seinfeld type of an individual sit on the other stool.
Yeah.
And then he wouldn't say like this, like, hey, let's riff and just see what happens. He would go, now...
What's funny?
When I was coming up, we dressed up for a show. You kids don't. And then he just let it hang in the air, and then Seinfeld would have to respond on some level.
I went, when I was in New York, I was a gambling addict and shit. I always wanted a game of something, kind of could find a game to lose money on and shit, right? So they go, there's a poker game at the Friars Club. I didn't even know what the Friars Club is. Yeah. I didn't even know what it was. That's how stupid I am about comedy. So I go there. It's all old fucking guys playing poker and shit, right? But no big stars. It's like Freddie Roman. Like a real sub-level guy. I didn't even know these guys. But they were all old and shit. And I'm like, I've slept. I've been playing all these card games in New York. And I get to the Friars Club. And they're not playing for much money. But I just want to play. Anyways, I notice... Like in my haze, like I notice these old guys keep calling me a fag. But it doesn't register right away, but because I'm trying to concentrate. But then finally I hear a guy go, "Here's a queen for the queen." You know, I'm like, what? I'm not queen. What? So then some old guy next to me is like, he's like, kid. So he takes me in the back. I'm like, what? He's like, you got to give it back as good as they give it. You know? I go, what? He goes, that's the only way they'll respect you. So I'm like, oh, fuck, you know? So then I go back, we're playing for a while. I call an old man a fag. He gets mad at me. It was so ugly. It was terrible. I didn't want to do it.
And they're playing for like a nickel.
Yeah, they're playing for nothing. Yeah. And so he got hilarious. Sad. He probably maybe he was secretly gay or something. I probably picked the one guy that was secretly. Yeah.
Well, that's the thing is, I remember I did one of those roasts, like the real Friars ones, not the conversation ones.
Yeah, yeah.
And I mean, I just swallowed mouthfuls of my own vomit. I just died. And then afterwards, Freddie Roman said in a newspaper article about how some of the comedians did poorly and they really need to take a class on comedy from the other guys. And I felt bad because, like, Freddie. I grew up respecting these guys. Like, yeah. Freddie Roman,
you
like,
knew him?
I really, oh, yeah, he was my sponsor.
Because you're from the East Coast.
Yeah, I.
Sponsoring booze? What?
No.
Comedy sponsor?
Yeah, he pays for this podcast. He sponsors it. No, I joined the Friars Club, and he was my sponsor.
Oh, I got you.
He was a good friend of my dad's.
Yeah.
So I grew up watching these guys. The
Wait, was your dad guys. A comic?
My dad was a big radio guy in New York.
Oh, awesome.
Yeah, he was the scribe of the Friars Club.
Oh. Was he a friend of Herb Schreiner?
Yes, old he Herb was, Schreiner? Matter of fact.
That's pretty cool.
Even the names are old school.
My dad said you were a fag. But it was hard getting critiqued by those guys because I really do look up to them still. I still think that they're like the real journeymen because there was no TV for them. They really did it like just for the love of the game.
Right, 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 right.
You know,
like one time I was in a writing room and there was an old guy there. He was his name was Jerry Belson, but he was a writer and he was like, oh, these new writers, they fucking come from Harvard and shit. They want to be writers their whole life. But he was 60 or 70 or something. He said, not me, man. When I started, everybody thought I was fucking crazy. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like to be a comedy writer, you know?
Well, they were gag writers at first.
Gag writers, yeah.
Paid no money and they'd write a couple bits for...
Yeah, just stand out in the hall. That's where kids in the hall got their names, you know that?
Is that true?
Because Benny had Benny would say, oh, we don't have good enough jokes. Go see what the kids in the hall got. And then there was the gag writers out in the hallway. Oh.
Huh?
I give you that packet, that Woody Allen packet.
That where was
he,
awesome.
Yeah, he wrote these jokes. Did I get it from you? It was for Herb Schreiner.
No shit.
And it was all these bits, and some were for in character. And then it was like, here's some other ones I wrote on my own. And it was a packet like Woody Allen. It was weird seeing him like trying to win someone's approval, which he hasn't done almost ever, I think, like in his work in a way.
Well, I like Mark's outlook on life.
Yeah, let's get back to that.
Give him a,
because this isn't fascinating. You know?
Because I find the same way, like people, because people always expect me to be angry when I lose something, and I go, "What the? How the fuck? It's so lucky to be here in the first place." You know, I mean,
I think if
you were Orson Welles or some shit, you'd be bitter. He didn't even seem that bitter. You know what I mean? Like
totally.
Like those guys, you could see. And then when you read in Hollywood, fucking Fitzgerald came here. You know what I mean? Actual novelists came here and got treated like shit by the studios. You know what I mean? And then you go, what do I got to complain about?
Yeah, but I think you could say that about anybody. I mean, you can always find someone shittier than you. Like for me, I always feel like when things are really bad, you got to go to like the third world to make you fall. What am I complaining about? You know, like that's one of my tweets. Got to be coming up in the future. It's like, well, at least I'm not sucking a dick for a soda can.
That's the third world. I didn't have that image.
Oh yeah, well they'll do anything. But the your personality is really like people think of you as a deviant and you have addiction issues and all that stuff.
Wait, what?
But people would say that you're like self-medicating or you're escaping with gambling and all
like
that stuff.
People would say.
All right, I'm saying it. I would say, all right, let me say it. You're right.
Yeah,
that was bullshit.
Yeah.
You have a gambling problem.
I did, yeah.
And you have substance abuse issues.
I don't have substance abuse issues.
Do you want a beer?
No, I don't drink.
He doesn't drink.
Oh, that's right.
I actually don't drink so like strictly that people think I'm an alcoholic.
Oh, no shit.
Just an odd paradigm, you know.
It's like somebody thinks you're married just because you never get laid.
Somebody thinks you're what?
Married because you never get laid.
Yeah.
That'd be like a humorist. So...
with alcohol especially, I guess because it's so prevalent. But obviously, if you said, I don't smoke weed or I don't do cocaine, people wouldn't think you had a problem with it. But if you don't rigidly don't drink alcohol.
Yeah.
Then they usually think you're an alcoholic.
My friend was the same way. He started just carrying wine around. He didn't even drink that just so people wouldn't, you know, just think he had a problem. Because that's
yeah.
You're entirely correct.
You know what I used to do because I don't drink? I go to bars. And maybe I told you this. I probably told you this. I just pretend to be drunk to get girls. Because I noticed I'd be talking to girls and fucking they'd all be like, what are you? But then a drunk guy would be pawing them.
Right.
Shit. So I said, fuck it, I'll just act drunk.
Yeah.
So I'd say inappropriate things, paw at them, and they just giggle.
Oh, yeah, yeah. It was like Paul Newman in The Hustler when he, not The Hustler, The Sting. Yep. When he would pretend, he pretended to get drunk on that train ride so that he could throw those guys
plays,
out of the car game.
Yeah. Yeah, he played.
It's a skill.
That was a great scene.
You got to look wounded. You got to look vulnerable.
He acted drunk in The Hustler, too.
Yeah.
In the first
God,
scene.
I never put that together. Yeah. He's done it twice.
He's a great acting drunk guy.
Yeah.
He in The Verdict. Yeah. I mean, he's great. He plays a drunk really, really good because he plays a drunk trying to keep it together. You know.
Days of Wine and Roses.
Well, that was Jack Lemmon. But
Jack
Lemmon. Yeah.
I'm sorry, your name again? I get confused.
You know what was cool about Days of Wine and Roses? I didn't even see it coming because I never heard about the movie. For the first half of the movie, it's like a romantic comedy.
Yeah.
It's like all sweet, and then it all goes to hell. It's
like
brilliant.
Which part is the comedy where you've got the crippled, limping woman at the beginning? Who's...
No, you're thinking of a different movie.
No, Days of Wine and Roses. She had a limp. She had a sad limp.
You're talking about The Hustler.
Nope.
What's he talking about, Mike?
Days of Wine and Roses. What's the woman's name? Who
Piper
was
Piper Laurie?
Was it animated?
No.
The one you're thinking of?
Keep going. You might keep interviewing Mark McGrath.
Are you thinking of the other? Are you thinking of Lost Weekend or something?
Maybe I'm thinking of Lost Weekend.
Yeah, Days of Wine and Roses. Jack Lemmon and somebody, Piper Laurie, something like that. And they're all happy, and everything's a lark. And then halfway through the movie, it all goes to hell.
Because of drinking.
Because of drinking. Then he quits. He gets her drinking. Then he quits. And then she ends up sucking off dudes in a hotel.
For money?
Yeah. And that's the end of the movie. Like, he's in AA. Maybe it was one of the first AA movies around. And he goes to her and he goes, come on. She's like, get away, you know?
Yeah.
So he's destroyed this other person's life with his...
So it ends poorly, too? I haven't seen it.
Yeah,
so there's no Hollywood wrap up.
No,
the first movies like that too.
Probably. Yeah, probably.
Okay, I'm glad I came to insert that.
Well, I mean,
now even the Bad News Bears have to win. I mean, like now, literally, I think no one has the balls to make an unhappy movie. I don't know if they do. It's only once in a while.
Did the Bad News Bears win it
when they remade it? They would not allow them to lose. Like it just didn't make sense.
Really?
And that's the whole heart
of it.
That's
the whole movie.
I know, the whole thing.
That's why you don't remake that movie, man.
I know.
Come on. Yeah.
But also, like, if you think about it, if you look at the top 10 best movies of all time, even Casablanca, all of them, they're usually not happy endings.
No.
They're like a bitter, it's not even bittersweet, but sometimes it's just like a great sad ending, you know?
Well, a lot of times you get the screeners, you know, from the academies when the Oscars are coming up.
Yeah.
And those movies, which are the best ones, all have very sad endings. But then the ones that do the big box office are always the ones that, you know, what was the one that you were in with Kevin James and Chris Rock?
Mall Cop?
You're dying.
Where Kevin swung a rope into a tree.
Oh, yeah. I wasn't actually in it.
No, you were in it. You were naked.
No, that was a double.
No, it wasn't.
Yeah, my stunt double made it in.
No shit. That's all they kept of you?
Yeah.
Really? I didn't know that.
Wait a minute. So you spent like a week filming stuff?
I spent 2 months. And I kept telling them they're going to cut it out of the movie. Because this is my character in the movie. It was a guy who showed up, like, because it was about a movie about all these guys who went back to their hometown, right? Yeah. So I was the guy that I never left my hometown. So I would show up and go, hey, guys, what are you doing? You know? And they go, oh, we got to do, you know, hey, can I be part of it? But no, no. So then I was like, that's my every scene. I go, geez, that seems pretty cuttable. I'm virtually a guy showing up wanting to be in the movie. And they're like, no, it's funny. I go, yeah, I don't know.
Why do I think I saw you in that movie?
Well, for one moment, my stunt double goes down a slide and then has his big hairy ass. I've been in two movies where I refused to do it, and then they got a guy with a big hairy ass.
and he's the only thing that stays in the movie. That's great. Why is that so funny? You know who else that happened to? Was John Stewart was in
Clown?
Wives Club. It was First Wives Club, which was a fucking big movie.
Yeah.
And it was like, you know, he was at that crossroads where he was a stand-up and getting a little bit of hosting gigs. And then this was going to be his movie career, you know? And ended up every single... And I mean, same thing. Like a month filming it, everything on the cutting room floor. And he went, I'm fucking going on TV. I can't... The movies.
Man. I remember that. He had like a deal with Harvey Weinstein and stuff. He was going to be in movies.
Yeah.
And shit. I think he had one movie or something.
I was going to ask Mark.
How many movies have you been in, Mark? 12? Like 12?
No. We played ourselves in Scooby-Doo. Thanks for asking. And
oh, really?
Yeah,
Scooby-Doo. That's cool.
It was very quick, dude. I've been no movies, real movies. I'm stoked to hear you talk, Norm. I'm a big fan. And I have the best seat in the house, dude. So
Scooby-Doo.
I'm not gonna bring this to a screeching halt and talk about my life.
I want to see Scooby-Doo.
Make sure you go see that one.
But you know what? You ever see? This is what happened to me because of the computer and shit. I saw Winnie the Pooh. You know. Because I like fucking cartoons a lot. So I went to see the new Winnie the Pooh. So I'm like, and I loved it. I thought, fuck, this movie's fucking great. Then a guy sends me a link. I think I'm a retard. I like Winnie the Pooh. And the guy sends me a link to this review that said it's a postmodern classic. So I'm like, oh, maybe I liked it for like some reason that I didn't know.
I saw Shrek 4, and it was about his midlife crisis.
Yeah.
And it profoundly affected my midlife crisis and helped me get out of it.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Really?
He was like an ogre who longer scared people, and he sort of like made it, and he had some money, and he didn't have his edge anymore, and he was like had two kids. And
I love stuff like that.
I mean, some of those movies are I was talking
about postmodern? Because I don't know what that means.
Postmodern means that it was modern.
Yeah.
And then
you don't know what it means. Yeah. I don't know what it means either.
We were in a movie once with Ivan Reitman directing, okay? With Billy Crystal and Robin Williams, a remake of a French movie that was huge called Father's Day. Okay, now Ivan Reitman directing, Billy Crystal and Robin Williams for the first time in a movie and, you know, starring our band in 95.
Wow.
We were nothing. And we thought it was going to be the biggest fucking thing ever. We were so excited. Opened to 12 million, drifted away. You see it on like Showtime every now and then. That's my story. I'm going to take a pee.
No, it's amazing how you see movies.
He's really going. He's committing. He's actually going into the bathroom.
He left the building.
It is amazing when you see movies on HBO, like the biggest. You never even heard of the movie.
And they have the big,
the biggest stars in the world. You go, how on earth did this movie never open?
Never went to the theater, right?
Well,
how's that work with movies?
How would I
test it or something, and then it doesn't work out?
People lose faith early in movies, I think, sometimes.
Well, I think even before it comes out, sometimes you're already fucked because, you know, say it is a Harvey Weinstein movie, and then he's got another movie, and he's got to sort of pick one to be his fall release because, you know, the Christmas release is where you – and so there's all this politicking that by the time – I mean, you experience this with your show on Comedy Central. There's so many elements that can go into the success or the pickup of a show that have nothing to do with how good it is or even sometimes how many people are watching it. It has to do with what the sponsor's like or is there a show coming after it that they'd rather set up with another show? Or how would you describe...
I guess you're right.
Well, when you think about your show, which I got to honestly say, people say, well, you know... it was just sports, so how many people are watching sports? And I said, yeah, but how many shows have Norm Macdonald just telling jokes for half an hour? Like, it just doesn't get, and I'm not blowing smoke up your ass. This is what I genuinely say is, like, I could watch you sit and tell jokes for half an hour. I don't give a fuck what it's about, and I never felt like it excluded people from watching it. So what do you think, looking back on it, would they say is the reason why it was canceled?
I don't know what they would say, but I would say the reason is that sport has sports in the title, so no lady would ever turn it on. That's what I would think, personally. Like, I go, why would a lady turn a show on that says sports?
Yeah.
So then you cut half your audience. Then you're kind of dead if you're only going after half.
I guess so.
I don't know. That's all I can figure.
Yeah. Well, it was a goddamn shame, and I guess I think they lack balls in not picking it up for second season.
They go through a lot of shows, though, man.
Yeah, and the ones they do pick up,
I was talking to Dimitri Martin. I, I thought his show lasted a long time. He told me only lasted two seasons.
Yeah, because they take a year and a half off between seasons.
Right, right.
And like Sarah Silverman's show.
Oh, right, right.
They so shot the pilot, like and then it sat on the shelf for 9 months, and all of a sudden Herzog went, hey, where's that Sarah Silverman pilot?
Really?
And the executives went, oh, no, it didn't test well. And they go, can I take a look at it? And he goes, put this fucking show on the air. And it was a big hit, and then it took them 9 months to order a second season. Wow. So by the time you're a Sarah Silverman fan, all of a sudden you're like, forgot what the goddamn show was.
Right, right, right. Of course, yeah.
So they got a new regime over there at Comedy Central, and that Alterman is a really talented guy.
He's a great guy.
No, he's a great guy. I think part of it is what you just said. I think they are, and I worked on the show with Norm, they are, and Lori Jo did too, who's here, they and Ben, they...
Jesus Christ, Mike.
They are...
You want to give the fucking grips and the gaffers credits?
Also, Audible.com is a sponsor, is that
yes.
right?
So get a free one if you go to audiblepodcast.com/Greg.
It's a great pod commercial, by the way. I listen every week. I think it's a new regime. I think there's a lot of change, and I think they're trying to find.
By the way, you know
identity.
TV is evil when they. It's a regime.
It was a coup. It was a coup. But and also, you know, they're picking up a lot of shows that would that figured into their decision, which is they're searching for their identity, I think. And that's not slamming them. I just think that's what happens. You know, they're trying to change, I think, a bit.
So what's the
you know, a lot of shows got lost in that shuffle.
All right. So, Norm, you're a producer, writer. You've got Mark McGrath. You know that he's interested in doing television.
Yeah.
And you've got the juice say.
He's on the TV.
No, he's not anymore.
You're
got
not?
Canceled. Yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Yeah, we got canceled.
Oh, I'm sorry about that. I didn't know that.
Don't worry about it.
But so he's available. He's likable. He's got a positive attitude. Good looking dude.
Yeah.
You tell me, what's the show that you would produce for Mark McGrath right now that you think can't lose? You know, because sometimes it's hard to think of a show for yourself. Like you,
yes.
You thought of a sports show because that's
no, it's very hard
your
to think
passion.
For yourself.
Yeah.
Like you, don't you think?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean,
because you have the wrong perception of who people think you are, right?
Absolutely.
I do, for sure.
Oh my God, yes.
You know,
when people tell you what the, or even like, because people come up to me sometimes and go, "Hey, I do an impression of you." I go,
"Oh yeah,
that's always fun."
Yeah, oh my God.
You go, you go, that's cool. You don't have to do it. And I go, "No, I sound just like."
I don't have to do it.
And you're like, all right, let's hear it. And then the guy's like, hey, what's that? And you go, oh, fuck.
Oh, my God. That's worse than getting Sam'd.
That's the worst.
That sounds
the worst.
Yeah. Crack. You're like, what?
All the packets would come in, and there'd be a page, three quarters of the front page of the word crack whore in every joke. But also, one time, you know what's fascinating? Getting a little more.
But that just
meta.
To cut you off, that would be the funniest thing to do to celebrities. Just that's your thing.
Yeah.
You see a celebrity, you just go, "Hey, I do an impression of you," and then you just go, it's like you just do it there, and you get your friend to videotape it every time.
No, I remember reading Andy Rooney got incensed because he said I looked at every tape because I've never said in the entire history of 60 Minutes, he never said, have you ever noticed?
Yeah.
Did you ever notice?
Yeah.
Like he never said it.
Yeah.
So now people are making up this shit, you know, to do an impression.
Well, you know, Rick in Casablanca never said the famous line.
Play it again, Sammy. He said,
never
play
said
it, Sam,
it.
Right?
That's right.
Yeah.
But a little deeper than that once. I remember we were in the writer's room, and obviously every writer has written this, and also people think they describe – one of the first words in describing Norm Macdonald's comedy is sarcastic. And we're sitting there, and I had mentioned that or something, and Norm's like, I'm not sarcastic. No, I'm kidding. and Norm goes
You're a regular humorist.
I'm not sarcastic. Like he was kind of like really thinking about it. He's like, I'm not sarcastic. And then there's a little beat. He's like, I think the opposite is I state exactly what's going on. And I thought that
post-modern.
Was modern. It was post-modern.
That actually is what postmodern.
No,
is.
But it was fascinating to think about that. I thought
because obviously like sarcasm to me is not a compliment. You know.
Yeah.
But you'll be like, they can't take your Heisman away unless you kill, you know, your wife. Like, you say exactly, you are, it's the opposite of sarcasm.
Well, I think it's seen as a way of hiding. You know, it's seen as a defensive posture to be sarcastic because you're not putting yourself out there in any way. And it's just like this whole new school of, you know, irony that the comedians, that the young kids are doing. It's so fucking uninspired. It's just like this comment on pop culture. And you can tell you're hearing it because every punchline is, really?
Oh, God.
Or, really?
Yeah.
And you don't need any joke. You just need to say right. something like, so Britney Spears is going on tour this summer. Really?
Oh, God.
Good really?
Point. Right.
And they all clap and laugh because they're fucking Viacom assistants and they have no juice. What?
What happened?
My producer's saying... Oh, okay. We're gonna run out of time.
Even people in regular life became like ironic and stuff. You know what I mean? And the worst is if you make a joke that's actually a funny joke or something like that, and then like somebody in a 7-Eleven or something will go like, "Boom, boom." You go, "What?"
Oh, yeah.
I don't even think they know what they're doing sometimes.
Oh, we just did a pilot. Mike and I just did a pilot together.
Yeah.
That we produced, and one of the notes from the network, among a lot of ones that. You know, and again, I don't want to alienate the whole network.
Yeah, yeah.
Literally, a note was, "Can and it's always we. Can
yeah.
we?
Yeah.
Can we put a rim shot there?" Oh, and you go like, "Well, God. We can't. We
have a scratch. We have a record scratch. I don't know about a rim. We can look."
But they meant it as not an insult. Probably they didn't.
The guy was telling a joke, and he was kind of an older guy who was a little right. bit corny.
Right.
And so I think it was meant as a sarcastic way of dealing with him.
How about a wee womp? We got that.
Postmodernism, according to Wikipedia, which is, I think, where fact starts and stops. The problem of objective truth and inherent suspicion towards global cultural narrative or meta-narrative.
There should be more.
I can't believe that Wikipedia fucking confused me.
Can I ask a question about Wikipedia? Are yeah. you supposed to add to your own entries? I have like a line, sentence and a half, and it's like, was on the Howard Stern show once. You know what I'm saying? Like, are you supposed to? It's probably the most vain question ever, and you guys are looking at me like I'm a fucking idiot.
I think if
you want to add this podcast.
I think yes. if anything, it's supposed to be written by as close to the source as possible.
Who's the source?
Well, that's just it.
Have you ever added an entry to your Wikipedia?
I've never even read my Wikipedia.
Okay. Norm, I'm sure you haven't.
How is that possible that you have not read your Wikipedia?
I have not read my Wikipedia.
Will you now? In front of
us? Ask my webmaster right now. Eliana, when's the last time I went to my Facebook page?
No, this is Wikipedia,
never.
Though. This is your legacy.
No,
you're going to leave this behind.
I don't
what
look
people
at
think
any
of
it.
You.
I don't look at any of it.
You've never read your Wikipedia, dude, ever?
I don't think I ever have.
You might not have one.
One time I was in a hotel, I was doing stand-up at a hotel in Calgary, a guy phoned me, he said, look at your Wikipedia. I looked at it, I said I died.
Wow.
In the hotel that I was in.
Jesus.
That I died that morning. And at first you think, like, maybe I
did.
Like, because you watch Twilight Zone and shit. And, but then after that, you're relieved. But then right after that, you go, fuck, it is going to say that one day.
Yeah. You know?
Good point.
And then you got to hire a publicist to tell people that you're not dead.
Did anybody pick it up, Norm?
No, I would have loved to have, like, later. I didn't know about screenshots and shit. Yeah. But because it just vanished afterwards. I don't know how a guy did it. I don't know how that stuff's done.
That's what I'm asking. Like, who adds to that shit? Because it's the weirdest, most random.
We're going to get to that question and others when we pick up on the podcast with Mark McGrath and Norm Macdonald, part two, in just a moment. Thanks for listening. Okay, we're back. It's part two of the Mark McGrath, Norm Macdonald, Mike Gibbons, Fitzdog Radio podcast. We just stopped down. We smoked some Salvio. Norm Macdonald dove out the window.
Salvio Benatore.
Salvia.
Salvia.
Tell him what I said. Yeah. Have you heard of Flo-Rita?
Flo-Rita?
Yeah.
Vic Tayback played it. What? No, I don't know. What is that? What is Flo-Rita?
Apparently, it's a hip band. And
have you heard of Flo-Rita?
Flo-Rita, no.
The hip-hop artist, yeah. He pronounced it. It's good you don't know that.
Sugar Ray. Have you heard of Sugar Ray?
Of course.
Well, naturally, they were asked to open up for Flo Rida, and I'm reading that in my notes from the lovely Horiana Halechko, who's my webmaster, and I mispronounced the name, and they giggled like a couple of school children.
Here's an interesting thing that brings up in my mind. Because, like, a podcast, I've been listening to them because somebody wanted me to do one. And then I can't make head or tail of them, right? And it seems like it's just like I hear you on fucking another dude's, and then he's on yours, and then another guy's on another guy's. And then people are like, hey, it's the future. I'm like, fuck, it seems like every host's 50. Like, how's it the future? I can't understand it. Is it the future? I don't know. Because I would think, why isn't there a 19-year-old on being the host?
It takes a certain gravitas to do a podcast. You can't rush that. It takes 45 to 50 solid years of living. And me and Mark Maron have that in spades.
How much is a fellow like what's a fellow like Mark Maron make on his podcast?
You'd have to ask Mark Maron. You can ask a fellow like me what I make.
Yeah.
Audible.com is one of the leading providers of audiobooks on the internet, and this podcast is brought to you by them. So I'm being paid by them.
Sure.
I do five podcasts a week.
Yeah, yeah. Nice.
And then I go out and I do two a week. But you know, I go out and make money in other ways.
Right. I liked your book. I read it. It was fucking
good.
Did you
really?
Yeah, it was awesome.
Oh, thanks,
I had to
man.
Get it. I think I left it here, so I had to get another one.
Oh, because
the last time you came, I signed a copy, and then yeah. You felt guilty because you left it behind?
I left it behind. I had to go get one.
I'm doing an audio. I recorded the audio version of it this past week. And, you know, the letters, I'm having famous people read some of the letters. So Mark's going to read one, and I'd be honored if you'd read one.
Yeah, that's cool. That's a good idea, right?
Okay. Well, let's do it. I got the book right here. So, see, I got all kinds of people already read it. Saget read one.
Oh, yeah.
I've got Adam Carolla reading a few of them. Zach Galifianakis. A whole bunch. So I picked a couple that I thought might be good to read. Here's one.
Recent quiz average equals 54. Recent test grades, average equals 52. Any additional comments? I think he's trying, but he can't stay awake in class.
Perfect. You, sir, are now in the Dear Mrs. Fitzsimmons audiobook.
Wow,
you thought it was going to be hard, right?
Yeah, by Jared. It'll be super easy. It'll be a smooth transition.
We all have the same lawyer. My lawyer is going to sue me. All right, let's get back to Mark McGrath.
What's not, dude? You guys, I enjoy hearing your guys talk and just about, you know, Norm's perceptions
Mark,
of things.
What's
I can't
Mark's
hang with
like,
you guys.
We were talking in the break about salvia and drug advocates like Joe Rogan that are actual advocates of drugs, which they didn't used to be. You know?
Well, you just mentioned Timothy Leary earlier.
Well, yes, there were academics and there were intellectuals, but I'm just talking about nightclub comics. I was just wondering about Mark's experience with drugs because I don't know what it is.
Oh, I've had quite a few experiences with drugs. Used to do a lot of the cocaine, and the blow and stuff back in the day. Sort of. Part of the landscape of the rock and roll world, if you will. You know what I mean? But
yeah.
When I took my job at Exeter 2004, I remember my main concern was it's every day. You know what I mean? That was all my only caveat was, wow, Monday through Friday. And then I kind of settled down, and now I'm a father too. And, dude, I'll have a beer every now and then. You know what I mean? So I came out unscathed, luckily. I mean, relatively
really?
Unscathed.
So when you were on cocaine, you never had
I would never say I was on cocaine, Norm. You know what I'm saying?
Okay.
But what I did.
Right.
No, it sounds like, you know, we were on cocaine for like a period of time.
Well, that's what I don't know.
Yeah. I mean, what I did, you know, dude, I had fun with it. I used it recreationally.
Okay. Once in a while.
I've done meth. You know, I've done done the acid and stuff. I've never done heroin. It's one thing I never
So you've never had a psychotic break or anything like that?
No, not really. You know, I've fucking done really stupid stuff, blacked out drunk on stage. Yeah. You know, not a bad place. I mean, a very bad place to do those things. But I've never had, like, have to be 12-step or anything like that. Yeah, Thank God. I've been lucky. You know?
That's probably, like we were talking about, that's probably either you're lucky or you're not with that kind of stuff.
I think I organically got to a space where I grew out of it. And that doesn't happen to a lot of people. You know what I mean?
Because I drank booze when I was a kid all the time. And then I stopped. And then it was easy.
Why did you stop? Though
I don't know, I don't know why I stopped. I was in I guess it was like you were saying, you forget a lot of stuff, and I used to love to fight in Canada, and then I moved to the United States because in Canada we fight, and we fight
cool,
in hockey,
right?
And nobody got guns,
yeah, good point.
And so nobody really gets killed, and you sort of fight for the fun of it. Then I got to the States and people, and I was at Saturday Night Live and I got in a fight in a bar and his glass crashed all over. Plus, I forgot I was on TV.
Right, that little thing.
And then, but then a guy said, that guy's connected. Like, he was connected, you know. I don't know if he really was or not.
That's scary.
But then I said, oh, man, I can't do shit like that anymore.
Was that the last fight you've been in?
Yeah.
Do you play recreational hockey, Norm?
I used to, but I fucked my... hey, how's your thing? I fucked up my... what do you call that?
Achilles.
Ah, Achilles, yeah. Achilles. Both of us. Both of us did the exact same thing.
Surfing?
No, I wish.
Oh.
No, it's...
Norm caused it, you told me.
I actually did thought... I did think
that's
Norm...
Really that.
I did think Norm kicked me. Because the doctor then goes, every guy sitting there says the same thing. Your Achilles pops. It's the thing right above your heel, between your heel and your shin or your calf muscle. And you turn around because you are convinced someone smashed you.
Really?
Yeah, and I thought I'd beaten Norm 2 games in a row, and he was behind me, and I thought he kicked me. And
seriously?
I swear to God. And
but here's what's fucked up is you said you weren't surprised.
But don't you reach a certain age, just talking about drugs, like you were saying, your father, you say, time enough, as the scriptures say, when you're a boy, you do boys' things, and when you grow, you leave them behind. But some people I'm amazed at that can, you know, in a way, I admire them in a sense. Like Dangerfield did it for his whole life.
Hardy.
Yeah, after he'd get out of a, he'd have a heart
crazy,
attack.
Crazy.
Hardy?
Well,
Laurel, from Laurel and Hardy? I'm sorry, Hardy. You said Laura, didn't you say it?
Laurel and Hardy.
Oh, okay. And then, but then why am I wrong? I was going with you.
To me, I feel like what Laurel Hardy did with the 12-step programs is he turned around silent films.
Now, like Keith Richards, you know, some people have a constitution for it forever.
No, but
you know?
That's the thing is some people, John Wayne apparently was a guy who no matter how old he was,
that's what
he would
says.
Be, you say John Wayne is gay?
That's for sure.
What about John Wayne Gacy? I feel like guys like that, John Wayne would be the last guy.
Why did I laugh so hard at that? Was that too obvious to you guys as comedians?
No.
The John Wayne Gacy thing?
I just thought of it because...
No, it's too obvious, right? Because like that's how fucking lame I am. I think that's the funniest thing I've heard.
No, there's so many levels you can take it on.
No, but
Laurel Hardy
would
have taken that piece of comedy.
You would not indulge him on that, right?
A little. It was an add-on. It was all right. It was good.
We've probably heard Gacy added to the end of John Wayne a couple times in our lives.
All right. I'm new.
Let's get focused. My point was that John Wayne would drink all night with all the younger actors in, and he would be the first guy on the set the next morning. Like, that's how some of those guys were built.
All right.
Microphones are really good on broadcasting. He's unbelievable. He's been doing this shit for like 4 years with me, and he literally will just start talking into the air while we're recording something.
Peter O'Toole, obviously all those guys, Richard, what's his, Harris and all those. But Peter O'Toole is so thin. I don't know how those guys do it. They're really like guys that don't seem like Richard Burton. They're not like kind of beefy and maybe can stomach some blows. And then they do it, and they're in their 80s.
It's the funniest drunk guy to me on YouTube is... because very few people know YouTube as good as me. By the way, I saw a new Orson Welles one. It was an Orson Welles unaired pilot where he's interviewing. It's a talk show. Unaired talk show where he interviews Burt Reynolds for an hour.
What year?
Pretty amazing. Like 1980, maybe? Oh,
that will be on Fitzdog.com. Eliana, get on it.
Oliver Reed is the greatest drunk guy ever.
Amazing.
On British talk shows. Oh, my Lord God.
You mean he was blind drunk.
And
is that
angry.
What killed him, though? Because he died during Gladiator.
He died in a bar, yeah.
Yeah. Wow. Amazing. But, like, unbelievable. He's the actor. Like, he's the guy. Whatever. He's in Gladiator.
And then isn't it true Dean Martin was faking it the whole time?
I don't think. That's what people say.
What about Forrest Gray? Or Forrest Tucker? Was it Forrest Tucker?
Forrest Tucker, yes. He had huge cock.
Yeah, but he was on all those roasts back in the day, and that he was always drunk like this.
No, that's Foster Bryce.
Ah,
Forrest Tucker was F Troop.
But Forrest Gregg is like the coach of Auburn football or something, right?
Forrest Tucker was F Troop.
I'm a fucking idiot. What's his name again?
Forrest Whitaker.
Foster Brooks.
I can't as quick as you guys.
Dean Martin would go, ladies and gentlemen, Mickey Mantle wasn't always in the big leagues. For a long time, he played the minor leagues. We had one of his umpires. Ladies and gentlemen, umpire Foster Brooks. And then Foster Brooks would come out go like, Mickey, Mr. Mantle.
Hysterical, though.
And
hysterical.
Yeah, it was hysterical. And he was more drunk than Dean Martin. Yes.
But was he drunk for real?
Not Foster Brooks. Yeah. I believe Dean Martin was drunk. I know people say he wasn't. I saw him. You know, one of the biggest stars I've ever seen in my life. He was at the Hamburger Hamlet all the time. You know?
Yeah.
And he, you know, he'd have a bunch of shot glasses in front of him.
That's actually the great thing about L.A. is that, you know, people lose their shit when they see a famous person, like, you know, in the Midwest or something. But if you're in L.A., like, an aging actor, you can find them. Like, you actually, like, I remember, what was the woman who was always at the Silver Spoons Diner in West Hollywood single day? From the original Titanic?
Shelley.
From the original Titanic?
Shelley Winters.
Amazing.
Yeah, you could go, you could sit. What did you say?
Titanic. The original Titanic.
Kate Winslet? Yeah. You could sit down with her. Like, you could go to the Silver Spoons Diner and sit down with her.
Yeah, Nibblers, which is right across the street from my Nibblers, would always be, and they'd be so happy. Because I'd always recognize him. It'd be like Alan Melville. It'd be some guy like, you know, that would be in a lot of old All in the Families or Dick Van Dyke shows, these character actors, you know.
Right. You know who another one was? In the same Silver Spoon, Robert Forster, before Quentin Tarantino, plucked him out.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
He was one of Quentin Tarantino's, like, I'm going to pull you out of obscurity. And he kind of did, I think, for a while.
I never told you this story, Norm, but I was I went to play golf in the Valley one day. We got to play golf, by the way. I remember we were supposed to play. I play with my son once a week now.
You did?
Yeah, he's 10. We go right to Penmar, play 9 holes once a week.
I played Penmar. I just played it. Come. Five,
yeah, let's go out.
I'd love to.
So I go to play golf at Hanson Dam. You know that course up in the Valley? It's off the 118. It's great. And so I'm there with Jackie Flynn. You know that comic?
Yeah.
And we're going to play, and so they say we're going to put you with two other players. And so we're standing there waiting for the two other players, and over walks O.J. Simpson and his friend. And so I just look at the heavens like, thank you, comedy god, for this opportunity. You know, 4.5 hours on a course. And Jackie Flynn, being from Boston, goes, fuck that. I ain't playing with that fucking murderer. And so O.J. kind of just he didn't even get angry. He just sort of turned around and, you know, sauntered off. And I was always curious what you would have done in that situation.
Me? I don't see. Listen, man. Like, I was like, fuck, I don't give a shit about any of these people. I don't even think of them as real people. Like, everybody was angry when that Casey Anthony.
Yeah.
I don't give a fuck. Like, that's just some lady with a killed her kid. I don't care.
Yeah.
So if I met Casey Anthony, I'd just be, she's a celebrity.
She's
kind of
hot.
Yeah. Well, actually, when I spent most of my time during the trial looking at her tits. Because I don't get sad about stuff like that. I don't know if there's something missing in me or, but I don't give a fuck if somebody killed their kid. I didn't know her in the first place. I didn't know she didn't kill her kid, you know? It's hard for me to really get all outraged about stuff.
That's funny because that's in theory, according to some people, why you lost your job at SNL is because you were taking shots at OJ and Don Allmeyer, who was running NBC at the time, sort of, correct me if I'm wrong, if this is an urban myth, kind of laid down the line that you were not to make OJ jokes any longer because he was a neighbor of his.
Well, yeah, that's what they said. But still, if I met OJ, I would be like, you gotta go, fuck, goddamn, I want to hang out with that guy. Well, and when actually, we were on sports show, I tried to get interviewed.
Norm Macdonald talked to OJ's lawyer for half hour on the phone trying to get an interview with OJ in prison. That happened 4 months ago.
Well, the lawyer said, this was funny, he goes, oh, I bet OJ would do it. He didn't have no idea who I was, right? And so it was very funny to think, because when he came back, he goes, are you a comedian?
Are you and that?
I go, yeah. He goes, oh, you're the comedian, Norm Macdonald? You're a comedian? I go, yeah. He goes, oh, yeah. He goes, OJ doesn't like you at all. And I just imagine this retard lawyer like going to OJ, and then OJ going, what the fuck? What are you talking? Because he probably went like it was a big, like.
Yeah.
Big pitch.
They're willing to pay, too.
Yeah. Like my my manager's assistant phones me up. He got a new assistant, so she phones me up all the time. And I tell her, stop doing that, you know. She phones me up. She goes, Norm, we have a wonderful opportunity for you. I go, really, what is it? She goes, Vegas High Life Magazine wants to interview you. I'm like, you mean I'm doing that Vegas gig next month? Yeah, they want to do an interview with you. I go, you shouldn't start the sentence by going, it's a wonderful opportunity. But that's probably why he went in with OJ, you know, with this wonderful opportunity.
So wait, is OJ actively receiving interview requests? You know, I mean, like, how come there aren't more?
I think the guy needs to make money.
But how come there aren't more?
Because Mike Gibbons knows. Mike,
that's what I'm saying.
Knows who my favorite guy in the world is that's behind bars, who I think's the funniest guy ever. He's serving time right now.
Oh, yeah.
70-year-old man.
The guy ripped off everyone's money in New
Never
York?
Never killed anybody.
Charles
Mitch. Yeah.
Oh, jeez.
That guy cracks me up.
Oh, but he's obsessed with him.
But the guy can't, they won't let him do interviews anymore. You've seen all those interviews. Oh, my God. And to me, if you're switching the channels and that fucker's being interviewed, you watch it.
Absolutely.
And what's funny about him, to me at least, is every other guy, every other like Son of Sam, or these guys are so creepy and scary and shit. But he's hilarious because he turns it all on the interviewer all the time. Like, it's always your fault, you know?
Yeah.
It's like, come on. Like, you're the idiot, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
Come on, man. What do you think? And sometimes he actually makes valid points. Come on, man. And when he... Yeah, man, you did it to me. I've been here all my life, man. You put me here.
Yeah.
Are you doing Norm Macdonald right now?
You know, our neighbor, my neighbor, one of my... One of my best friends, homosexual, named Tom. Try a microphone. Again, it amplifies your voice and the recording device.
We're going to get a dinner together because he has to hear
so you know
what
about
Tom
him.
Knows.
My friend for 12 years.
He knew him first.
I knew him first. Most of Mike's friends I knew first, except for
Tom
the guy in Martha's Vineyard. But no, he's obsessed with this thing, and you know he just had to bring on a co-writer because after 12 or 13 years,
it's way more than
he had so much more so much research he couldn't wrap his head around it anymore. Oh, it was spilling out his ears, so they had to bring in a pro.
And he believes Bugliosi is a fraud, right?
Bugliosi is a fraud,
well,
completely.
From stuff he's done since then, it appears he's a fraud. You know what I mean? Like he did crazy stuff about George Bush and stuff.
Well, guys like that are one-hit wonders. You know, you're in the right place at the right time, and you become the guy who, you get to be Manson's guy, you know, because he got the story. But then you look
and
at
his was the best-selling whatever type of book it was of all time, a nonfiction crime book or something, whatever.
Is that true?
Yeah.
Oh, I would have thought it would have been...
Wombaugh's The Onion Field. Huh? I was guessing. I don't know.
No, I was gonna guess the very flamboyant guy from Truman Capote's In Cold Blood. I would have thought would have been the most. The microphone often
is that characterized as not.
It
was,
I mean, it's unfucking seriously, Mike.
It was a
we're
new
sitting
genre.
With Mark McGrath. We got Norm Macdonald,
a new genre.
And you're talking in the air like a homeless person.
It was new journalism.
That was what it was characterized.
He's
as.
Actually being very cordial to
new
me, trying to get me in. So I'll walk in.
Oh, don't do that. It was a new genre.
It was called new journalism. And how about how great Robert Blake is in that, who I'm trying to also get in contact with. This is the thing I realized with OJ. When OJ got found guilty, because Timmy Meadows said, oh, man, he's not guilty. And I was like, right? You're a smart guy. What? You know? But all the black guys know he's not guilty. But then I understood it when Robert Blake, because I loved Beretta. Yeah. And so I didn't give a fuck if he did it or not. I was so happy when he got off. And also, does it have to be the same fucking crime for killing? I mean, it might sound, I guess every life is equal, but is it really? Like, like if you kill JFK or you kill Bonnie Lee Bakley, you got to serve the same fucking time? I don't know. I mean, all life is precious and all that, but...
To a point.
To a point? Listen, what about the fucking guy that killed... what about, you know, whatever. If you, you know... I don't know what I'm trying to say.
Well, I'm going to stitch that into a pillow. I think that if you kill a black person in this country, statistically, you will do less time than if you kill a white person. That's fact.
Absolutely true.
What, that you think that's right?
I think that's wrong, but that's different. That's different. What you're talking about is different. I'm saying that you say, let's say you kill a 99-year-old man.
Yeah.
What are you fucking, you know, what are you really doing?
But that means abortion should be the worst crime of all murders, don't you think? Because that baby's brand new. No, I think abortion, I honestly think that...
Well, you have a friend.
I just talked about it on the radio show about how, you know, they say except in the case of rape and incest, that abortion should be... That's the bill now that's working its way through. So what they're saying is that it's... You're killing a human life, right? Except if it's rape, in which case... You can murder that baby because it was associated with a crime in some ways. Like that. How do you bring those two scenarios together in any logical way?
My opinion is you're saying that as a compromise to exclude rape and incest.
My point is you either believe it's life or you don't. But now you've got these Christians, these so-called, you know, right-wing, you know, true believers that are saying...
That are willing to compromise.
That are willing to compromise.
Unacceptable.
Yes.
Unacceptable. If you consider it a murder, you can't kill a baby of a rape victim. You can't kill a child of a rape victim. Right? You can't kill a two-year-old.
Exactly.
Who's fathered by a rapist. So,
well, fathered is a strong word. They rarely sired. Stick around and play ball with the kid or do anything like that.
Sired.
Yeah. Sired. Sired sounds like a horse. I think if you got...
Listen, man. You think rape is unnatural?
I mean, if you say it's unnatural, then you gotta... How did we get here? I mean, sex didn't involve a date when we were cavemen.
Not at all. And every time, I don't know why, you'd think it would be consensual in the animal kingdom, but every time I see it, looks like rape. Looks like the lady's running away.
Just trying.
Yeah.
That's what's called fucking back. Like, good sex feels like she's trying to get away, doesn't it?
Yeah, and I'm not... What?
I'm just saying, if rape weren't the natural state of things, why is the wildest sex as if she's trying to escape and she's
screaming,
yelling?
Help.
Well, I would I think what you're saying is that if the more civilized we become, the farther away from rape we get when it comes to sex.
Well, rape is, I guess, how we define our humanity, and yet I think that most homophobia stems from man's fear of being raped, which I find, you know, I don't know many instances of it ever happening outside of prison at all.
Sure it happens outside of prison.
When?
It happens in colleges and hazing in colleges.
I think the biggest fear, though, driving homophobia is that they themselves have some portion of themselves understands it and agrees with it.
This is why I disagree with that.
With what I just said?
Yes. Because
or with
if
that
you,
John Wayne's gay.
No, with what you say, that if homophobia, if gay bashing can be attributed to the gay basher being gay himself, then it's gay people bashing gay people. And then therefore no straight person is a gay basher. That's just a crime within their own community.
No, that's by why, that level but that's of why reasoning. I said some portion. And by the way, I didn't go to gay bashing. I just said homophobia.
Homophobia. Yeah, if homophobia is only a product, if it's only done by homosexuals, then it's not really a problem. It's just self-loathing.
But I'm not calling him a homosexual. I'm saying like.
But that's what you are calling him.
Well, no. Let's say it's my neighbor, made-up neighbor George, who's a dad with some kids. Let's say there's some portion, but he has this Christian upbringing or whatever it is. But there's some portion of him that he believes. It's okay, and could maybe see himself in his deepest.
That could be possible, but there's two things I don't like about it. One is I don't like a gay person insulting using a gay term to insult a straight person, because that doesn't make any sense. So if I see somebody going to us to, well, that guy's secretly gay. That's his problem. Why is that an insult? You're openly gay, you know what I mean? That doesn't make any sense to me. Also, why would the person have to be gay to hate a gay person? You don't have to be. You're obviously, you don't hate black people because you think you're black, you know what I mean? And they always have to try to blame the victims. The same with Hitler. He thought he had some Jewish blood in him. No, it's the otherness that they're afraid of. I don't buy that fucking bullshit.
Well, I think it's the same argument people used to say. I mean, speaking of rape, that they said it was a crime of anger, whereas it's not. I mean, I'm sure that it's more aggravated when there's anger, but I think it's sexual.
Yeah, it's sexual in the same way that fucking is sexual. Yeah, if the crime involves cum coming out of your cock, there is a sexual component to it. Without question. But listen to this. I think I could never rape on account of, and I don't admire rapists, but if a woman's fucking punching me in the face, I fucking get off my, I have a hard enough keeping it up if I'm late for my taxes.
Yeah.
You know, let alone that shit. Like, there's something, I'm not saying they're more something manly than I am, but they're more closer to being an animal.
Yeah.
Totally.
Have you ever tried to fuck right after handing in your taxes, though? Is that like the greatest sex for you?
No, but
you just fuck your accountant.
But have you ever had a girl go, oh, rape me? Like, because I'm not into fantasies and shit. You know, I can't do it again.
I had a girl ask me to slap her and pull her hair.
And did you do it?
Of course. I mean, I didn't feel like I wanted to do it, but I felt like it was something that would turn her on. And so I did it, and she got turned on, which then becomes this Pavlovian thing where then I like that she's getting turned on, so I'm pulling her hair more, and then she's saying slap me, and I was slapping her. And then she stopped liking it, but then I was so into it.
Yeah.
No, of course not.
No. But, Mark, were the girls on the road? I mean, what would the general girl on the road like? Would she like to be completely submissive?
Yeah, you know what I'm saying? These chicks, like, you know.
What expectations do they have of you?
Zero expectations.
No, them. They don't have zero? You can
I can't. I can't think of anything I'm thinking about right now.
In other words, did they need you to perform at a high level?
No, God,
no.
No, they just want to be part of the thing. But it got really dangerous for me. I wasn't like really a groupie guy. You know what I mean?
Did you see Madonna?
No. I kissed her on the cheek once, and they said, "Hey, Mark and Madonna are going out," which was great for me, bad for her. But I just wasn't in like really groupy scene, especially when I got some money. That I got scared of the whole rape charges and all that insanity. So I know I'm not making sense, but
no.
But let me just ask you this. This is a question I often ask my musician guests. What would be the quickest time from the last note you play on stage to being inside of a
funny,
woman?
It happened before Sugar Raven got famous. It was a gig we played in Newport Beach at like a shitty club, and there was this girl in the front row. I kind of knew her a little bit, and we were playing, and we stopped. Good night. I had my shirt off, and I was walking backstage down the steps. She grabbed me, and there was a little alley in the back way, and I could still hear the band going, and I was doing her dog in the alley.
Wow.
So, like, no time after, we were still playing. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And that was
Natalie Maines. Natalie Maines.
Natalie Maines on a plane. She hadn't even done the gig yet. And she was, no. But, Norm, let me ask you as a comedian, what's the shortest amount of time from your final punchline until you were having sex with a young woman.
Imagine being in the hotel room. Well, no, I think like I never had any. I've hardly ever gotten girls on the road, but in terms of, a guy did tell me, he goes, you know, which is interesting, which I've always found to be true. The longer you're off stage, the less like chance you have. Like the more you're just all of a sudden you're a normal guy. Hours pass, and then have no interest at all. And so he said, I know who it was, Rich Jenny. He said, take him right back to the green room. You know, immediately, right back to the, that's who it was, Rich Jenny. He would get the girl, and he was a real, like girls, that guy. He'd go, I'd get him right back to the green room, because the closest to when you're on stage is when you're still a giant to them, you know?
Yeah.
And the longer you're off, the more.
Yeah. The more they get to know you. I deplete the fantasy quickly. So, that was my.
I mean, do you guys remember when you first saw a guy, like, on stage and then off stage? Because I remember seeing this comedian on stage the first time I was ever in a comedy club. And then I saw him sitting at a table, and I was like shocked at how remarkably smaller he looked, you know?
Yeah.
Like I was amazed. Yeah. Yeah, and he looked like a giant on stage to me.
I remember we were talking about the Borscht Belt comedians before, and there was this show called the Catskills on Broadway, and it was.
I remember that.
Yeah, it was Freddie Roman and a guy named Malzy Lawrence and Dick Capri, and there was a woman thrown in there just for good measure. You know how they do that. And so the guy named which one was it? One of them, very short, and he wore a tuxedo. Malzy Lawrence. He wore a tuxedo and he was very short, and he had his hair was receding, but he slicked it back and it was silver. And he had this really elegant way. Like, if you were to take a snapshot of him during his set, invariably his arms would be outstretched or he'd be making a point. Like, he was just beautiful up there. He was elegant. And I remember seeing him after the show and literally would not believe that. Like, people were telling me, no, that's Malzy. I was like, no, it's not. It can't be him. That guy's 6'4". This guy's like 5'7". It's not him.
Right.
And I've always thought about that when I do stand up is like, you know, to think about how much bigger you look to people when I'm on stage, you know, not consciously, but it's almost like this subliminal thing of like, I'm giant to these people right here. I can get away with so much more if I just know that that's how they look at me.
That's true. That's very true. You never think of, I never really thought of myself as looking that way. But also those guys in those days, I'm always struck like when I see old footage of Bob Hope or Benny or something like that. And they were men, huh? But they were 30.
Yeah.
But you know what I mean? They had complete command with the tux and they were in control and they were men, not kids like us.
Yeah,
you know,
they
were something else, you know.
Or fat old Elvis, I think only made it to 41 years older. And that thing about that, we're older than Elvis ever lived.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
That's crazy.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
But also that
John Lennon was like three times retired or something.
Yeah.
Right?
Well, I remember I maybe did it to you, too, when our friends would turn 30. At that time, I would always like write a birthday card like, hey, happy birthday. The Beatles recorded everything by the time they were 30. You've done a lot, too. You know, it's so crazy, especially those guys. They looked like they were middle aged. They had been through divorces and midlife crises, gone to like India to find a guru. And they look like shit on the cover of Let It Be or whatever. And it's like they were fucking 29.
Yeah.
Well, like, you know, with Steve Jobs stepping down, and I was reading a lot about him this weekend, you know, when you think about somebody like that, like, he got out of college and he went straight to India and he tried to find spirituality there. And then he came back and, you know, the whole Apple thing happened. Then he got fired from Apple and then he went off and he founded Pixar. And, like, he talked about how, you know, for him it was always about, it was never about his age, and that's why he's talking about getting sick now. It just doesn't feel like him because it's – and I started thinking about, like, how you're really supposed to be living not for your legacy so much as what your possibility is. You know, and sometimes I look at my life and I go, like, what the fuck? I'm so settling in how I approach my career or even my family as opposed to, like – putting the family in a fucking car and driving across the country this summer, or, you know, going on stage and just breaking down all the conventions of stand-up, because there are none. You don't have to follow any of that. And at the end of my life, will I look back and say, like, I'm a kid because I never fucking just – I think it's really being in the moment in a way that it's owning it.
I'm reading, like, about Tolstoy, you know, because I'm like, who – you know, I've always loved him, you know, and I've read him and reread him and reread him, you know, and he said the most profound things that have ever been said. And then you find out, well, in the last year of his life, he said, God damn it, like, I've wasted my whole life. All I want to do is be ascetic, throw all this money, you know, he's nobility, throw all this money away and go and live, you know, go and travel and with nothing, you know, and walk the world alone. This was his thing, you see. And he went to the train station and collapsed, and they brought him home, and he died 3 days later.
Wow.
And this is Tolstoy.
Yeah, yeah.
You know,
yeah.
This isn't us. So he, you know, he knew that he had done nothing with his life, or at least he felt he had done nothing with his life. But he said, that, you know, because a lot of these guys, when they hit it, really, they go, well, asceticism is the most. That's the way to go. You know, just have nothing.
Yeah.
And
speaking of nothing with life, I can't hang with you guys, man. I got diapers to change in 4 hours.
Mark McGrath, you're a champion.
I love you guys. Norm, it's a pleasure to meet you, brother. Finally.
I'm just sitting here like
an idiot because I'm such a fan of yours, brother. Greg,
that's great.
Seeing you guys jive and do your thing, man. It's a real pleasure. Mike, you guys
Mark,
are amazing.
Mark, you're a champion, man.
You got here earlier?
How old's Mark's kids?
They're 16 months old. Yep. And they're getting up in 4 hours.
That's the greatest.
It's a good time. It's fun. That's why I'm at.
You know, you're a champion. You got here hours and hours ago, and you delivered a lot of good radio podcasting. Okay.
All right, guys. God bless.
All right. God bless, and drive safe. Drive safe. Be careful. Yeah, he's the real thing, that guy. I guess if you're always going to feel like a failure no matter what you do, then you might as well. I mean, I think it does. It comes down to like being in the moment. Do you ever read The Razor's Edge?
Yes.
It was the guy's whole journey. Was exactly
I love
that.
And I also love that Bill Murray made that movie at the height of his, right after Ghostbusters, and they hated him for it.
Yeah.
I didn't see it.
I don't want to see it. I feel like
I saw the original, even though it's not a hard movie to.
It's on the same mom, right?
Yeah, the book was amazing. The movie was hard to watch. And I'm sure it would be even harder with, I don't know, I think Victor Mature was in the first movie or something like that. But yeah, you know, all these guys seem to get to the same place, which is. Just physical labor and
yes,
and you know, when you think about it, man, when I think about physical labor, that's when I was at, I don't know, when you look back at your life, right? I don't know about you, but I don't think of being on Letterman or shit like that. When I try to think of happy things, I think of when I had nothing, when I was with my buddies.
Oh yeah,
it's, you know.
Yeah, it's when I was, well, even now I'd say, you know, having kids, I just saw how you responded to Mark having kids. It's like, and I think Mike shares this, is that you do go back to that in a sense, because like I built a tree fort with my kids, and I built a race car, you know, a soapbox car with them. And honestly, I could say in the last 5 years, those are probably, and teaching my son golf.
Yeah.
Those are the things that are like really not fleeting, like, yeah, but more of just like a sense of completeness that lasted. It was a sustained sense of accomplishment and of being in the moment and losing, you know, being able to push all other things out.
Right, right. And you know, when your kids get, like my kid just went to college, and he's not a kid anymore. You know, he's just a guy like me. But when I was talking to Lojo about it, I'd like to, if I could get with 4 and 5 year old kids, which is a big problem. To try to get that kind of job, you know, because a lot of people fuck kids.
Yeah.
And, but to get that, I mean, I remember Bill Maher is telling me, kids are stupid. He goes, why is family now based around children, you know? He goes, children are just stupid adults. That's his view of things. But I have the exact opposite view. I remember my child when he was in preschool. I remember going to preschool. It was the most wonderful place I've ever seen. It was the most magical thing I've ever seen, those children. Even if you see, like, kids say the darnest things or something, you know, it's delightful. You know? And are you familiar with Stendhal syndrome?
No.
Stendhal was, whatever his name was, I'm sure.
Stendhal?
Augustine Stendhal, whatever that guy was in the 16th century. But he had, you know, he showed art in an art gallery, and he had all the greatest art of Europe, you know, and people would come in. And they would sometimes suffer what later became known as Stendhal's syndrome. The art would overwhelm them, and they would actually break down and squeal with hysteria, and then cry, you know, and then go back and forth, you know, just from the beauty of the art.
Yeah.
And then it became a syndrome that now is more of just it doesn't have to be art. It's just. It can be that you're so sensitive to the world that you're constantly heartbroken, or you're constantly the opposite. But children have that. Children squeal with delight one moment and are crying the next. They feel terror at it. We can't feel the terror of a child.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Even though our terrors are real, but if we ruminate on death, we have these intellectual layers that have to get broken through. A child is much more terrified by a blanket hanging on the, you know, over on the bedstand that looks like a monster.
Yeah.
And it's real.
Yeah.
And that's what I love about children, is they're pure and they're real. And and when I see them when I saw them in the preschool, they were all different. And that's what, to me, I know society has to work and people have to get, you know, I guess they do. But when I go to see children, it's the most lovely thing, because they're all different and they're all beautiful and everything. And then they grow up and everybody's the fucking same. You know what I mean?
I was going to say, my friend Joe, who's an artist, he came over and he saw my really young daughter had painted something. And, you know, Joe's like struggling art, like really trying to make it. And that's all he does. And there was some portrait, and there were two suns in the picture, like two suns in the sky. And he was just like, he really was just stared at it for the longest time. I didn't really take notice, but he walked and he just pointed to it on the way out. He goes, I could never do that. And I was like, you could do that. I mean, you're the most imaginative. He's like, no, I could never do that and feel that that was the right thing to do, like your kid did. And then he went on, but I guess that is a really huge intellectual conversation that all artists have, like that. Stripping away convention, stripping away even the intellectual layers of sorrow or whatever it is, or terror. It's like he could never do it and feel that that is right. He would feel it was a contrived thing or an effort to do that. Like it would never be pure.
Yeah.
In a word.
And that's why like people say children are the future. I'm like, fuck that shit. They're the present.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, the future, they're just us.
Well, it's...
What the fuck is that? You know, you think they're going to grow up and be children and be, you know what I mean? They're just going to be like us.
No, it's because they're like, I mean, you could see some of the art of my daughter on the wall. That's a self-portrait up there. And the thing is, there was no fear at any point. Like sometimes we'll do this thing. Where
there's no fear. There's no ambition. There's no self-consciousness in that.
Yeah.
It's beautiful.
Yeah, and then we'll sit across from each other, and we do this thing where we both do portraits of each other at the same time.
Oh.
And mine are always correct in the angular part of her nose, and hers are always like almost make me see myself in a different way when I see them, you know?
Yeah. Yours are facts, and hers are truth.
Wow. See that? You got me there.
Especially because she always paints Greg on the road.
That would have been a great joke on the microphone. Mike said, especially since she always paints me on the road. you know, Mike's daughter masturbates with his shirt between her legs, right? You know that, right?
No.
You never heard that? You never told Norm that?
I know, not for any reason.
All right, tell him.
I told it on the radio.
You know that for a fact?
Oh, no, she used to masturbate a lot. So, but it was when she was like three or something. So what happens is then even like we talked about on the podcast and all these women that are on the radio show and all these women are calling in like, oh, that's freakish and all this. And it's like, well, I'm like, when did you start masturbating? And they're like 11. I'm like, 11? You're the pervert.
11.
My daughter won't be masturbating at 11. But then Greg went to a school and like asked the teacher because our daughters are about the same age. And the teacher's like, they are constantly doing it. The girls in the class, like we have to like always like be like, nah, that's for like when, you know, at home or not in the classroom. So anyway, She would do it a lot. So one time my wife asked someone, oh, you know, I don't know what to do. And she's like, well, you should ask her what she's thinking about. So Liz goes up to the room and anyway, and she's and the daughter's in there and she's going to town. And by the way, going to town is if we're going to get graphic about it, it's actually less graphic, I hope, than what listeners are imagining. It's laying face down, fully clothed, and it's humping something. So anyway. So Liz goes, so, oh, hey, how are you doing? And by the way, what are you thinking about? And she's like, daddy, which was awful. And what she was humping was my shirt, which they sleep with. Both daughters sleep, especially if I worked on like was working late or something and couldn't put them to bed. But this turned out sadder than funny.
Well, because we're talking about how beautiful kids are, and I guess what I was trying to get to with that, that it was to be ashamed.
Yeah, I hope.
I think that it's beautiful, you know, because you're every girl marries her father, right? So how many have masturbated to them though at such a young age?
All right, here's a funny add-on was to know then how then she was aware of it and it was supposed to be. Totally fine, totally cool, no judgment, but like in her room or whatever. So anyway, one time we're laying on the couch and she's laying on top of me and like the other one's doing something crazy and we're playing games and all that. And all of a sudden I feel a thing on my leg, like a moving on my leg. And I look down and she's not looking at me or anything. I'm just like, oh, is that really going on? So anyway, I just go, Sophie? And she just goes, sorry, and stops. Like, I thought for sure she wouldn't know what I was referencing or that it would be so shocking to her that I actually, it was noticeable, but it wasn't at all. She completely knew. She was all busted.
Yeah. You want to talk about kids more or you want to talk about something else?
Anything, man.
Anything but that.
Everything.
All right, I had some notes on some stuff that happened to me this weekend. Maybe we can talk about those.
Yeah.
I had, let's see.
Do you think it's possible to act like when you say in the moment and stuff like that? I've taken acting courses.
Yeah.
Three or four.
That's it?
Yeah. All right. Three or four times I've been in an acting class. And I always get to the same place where I'm like, I can't. It's hard for me. I always get in an argument with the professor because I say, listen, I can't actually believe this is the truth. That's what my thing is. And he goes, you got to. And I go, I can't. I can't. I think I would have to be insane to believe that this crescent moon over here is an actual moon, and I'm a guy named Fred. And I don't believe you believe. And that's another thing. I don't believe the professor can do it either. I don't believe anybody can do it except a psychopath who then would not probably be a good actor. I don't know.
Well, yeah, no, you're talking about method actors versus guys that are. Well, I think stand up to me stand up is about. I notice that the longer I do it, the less I hear my own voice coming out, and the more I'm. Even if it's a joke I've done a bunch of times, I still am up there, kind of having conversation with the crowd, like I'm listening to them and I'm responding to them, and it's like, and I think that's all good acting is becoming so, kind of. Unconscious of your of the context of what you're doing, that you can actually just realize that the audience is as much part of it as your lines or the other people on stage, and that it's all about, I guess, shifting the energy internally instead of externally.
Yeah, right. So you're being unselfconscious and. Is that what you mean?
Yeah, but you can't take a class to become unselfconscious. You're either, some people are born that way. Like you see
I'm
an actor.
I'm like you. I'm like, it takes me a long, long time with stand up.
Yeah.
And I heard Alan Arkin once say, anybody can be an actor. It takes 20 years. I don't know why. But maybe he meant the same thing. You just do it.
Yeah.
Until all of a sudden you're so saturated by it that you lose all self-consciousness or I guess whatever that is that.
But then you see someone like River Phoenix or someone who, like, as a kid actor or just immediately, or Leonardo DiCaprio, like, they didn't take classes, but maybe they did it as children or they did it young enough where they didn't see it as anything except for play. And in play, you're in the moment. And so maybe that was always their context for acting.
Yeah, I bet. I bet if you learned it when you're a child.
Do you think John Wayne felt he wasn't
Hold
gay?
Hold on a second.
Do you think John Wayne felt he wasn't gay?
The joke loses its punch.
No, it won't. It won't at all. We'll edit it out. Mike
but
Gibbons.
Again, see, I think you're guilty of using gay as an insult.
What? I want to talk about that.
Because I also, when you brought that up earlier, I wanted to mention, I think when gay people are angry at someone who's straight and call them, oh, well, they're gay, or they're pretending to be straight, according to the gay person, I think there's a degree, I think some of your point is valid, but there is a degree of the hypocrisy, which is infuriating, especially because it really hurts the cause of a better understanding and all that stuff. So,
but the criticisms are coming from people usually who've hidden their own gayness for years.
That's true. But
maybe they haven't attacked other people for being gay, but they by acting straight are by a sin of omission saying gays are bad.
Except in my case, I'm not gay, but John Wayne was, and so I have no agenda
other than.
Mike Gibbons, who's horrified by the fact that I almost had a gay experience in college while we were friends. I went into the woods and I was going to do oral sex on a guy just to find out if I was gay or not.
Listen, I have no problem with that.
And to me...
I mean, we talked about this in the writer's room.
Horrified.
You wouldn't talk about it with me. You wouldn't make eye contact.
I remember we were talking...
It was a different one
on the subway. That was a great story.
Oh, that's right.
No, it's a totally different story. Okay. I was just non-confrontational on the subway when you wanted to pick a fight with the poor gay gentleman across from us.
He wasn't gay.
I think that's what you thought. He was looking at you.
He was looking at me.
Yeah
actually, you know what? That was a homophobic
totally.
Moment for me. That was. Totally. I got really freaked out that a guy was staring at me on the subway.
We were talking.
Mike and I were talking, and the guy wouldn't stop looking at me. And then I just kind of flipped out, and I wanted to fight the guy, and he got off at the next stop. And it was... I think that was definitely homophobic.
You remember what I said to you before the next stop?
No.
I go, we were there, and he was sitting over there, and he couldn't hear us. But I'm like, I go, you know, I'm just going to pretend now that we're talking and that this is normal, and we're just going to get off at the next stop because the tension was so fucking crazy.
I guess I yell, I don't know. But, you know, I think...
But homophobia runs deep. I remember we were talking about this in the room, and nobody agreed with me in the writer's room once at the sports show. But I was like, why can't you, if you have a gay friend, why can't you whack him off and let him come? Use your hand. Why, unless you are so repulsed by it and think it's so disgusting to be gay, why can't you do that? That's got to be homophobia, right?
Well, here's what the right-wing Christian would say. Well, if your dog wants to come, should you jerk off your dog?
Yeah. I mean, why not?
I'm not saying there's a right or wrong answer. I'm saying this is what the Christian right would say. Well, he's saying if your friend's gay and you have no problem with him, then why?
I'm not saying what the Christian right would say. I'm saying what the secular left would say to that.
The secular left would pretend that it enjoyed jerking the guy off, but inside would be horrified.
Would they do it? You think though?
They have to. If you said it that way, they'd have to.
But they wouldn't occur to them to do it. It wouldn't occur to them to go. Listen, Phil. You know, you don't have a date tonight. Do you want me to whack you off? Would you enjoy that?
No, but I think the secular left.
Or you want me to suck you off?
Once you suggest.
I'd suck a guy off.
Like, you'd suck a guy off? That's different.
I don't want no cum in my mouth or nothing like that. But
well, there's pre-semen that comes out very often.
Other than the germs thing, I'm saying I would suck a guy off and my cock wouldn't get hard or nothing. I wouldn't get turned on by it. But I think I could easily do it. It wouldn't bother me or make me think I was gay in any way. The only way I would think I was gay is
if you wear a hat, you can spit in your hand and pretend, you know, just get your hand down, like put the brim of the hat over the guy's
What's a
cock.
Hat?
Like a baseball cap.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You put the brim over his dick and then you spit in your hand and use your hand on
him. Yeah, I'd do that. But here's the other thing. Also, if it turned me on, then it'd be fine. That means I'm gay.
Well, that's why I was going to blow that guy in the woods.
You were
I wanted to know.
You wanted to know. And I've had experiences like that where, because this is the thing with gay guys that I know, and I maybe straight guys are the same, but gay guys are always like, you know, because people have a problem realizing anyone's different than them. So they go, you're gay too, you know, you just don't know it. You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
Especially if you're somewhat accepting of them, you know, and not angry at them all the time. They take that as a sign that maybe you're...
Mike said they also take it as a sign when you're blowing them, and then he did a fake yawn.
It's just the rigidity of your cock is the sign of you being gay or not.
I don't
else.
Think that's true either, because I know one of the problems with molestation of boys is that they've never been excited with their penis before. They don't know. There's no connection to sexuality. Very often they did feel something, and then they don't know. As a matter of fact, my friend who is
gay
was molested, and he couldn't come out of the closet till he was very old because he associated that turning on with something bad.
Right.
Well, I guess what I'm saying is that, like, I think even if you were...
I mean, I'm coming out fruitier than Carmen Miranda's hat.
Not with that reference. I don't even care.
That's a solid... What do you think is the... The roast is coming up. Let's talk about that. The Comedy Central roast. Who are they roasting this year?
Charlie Sheen.
Tyson is on the dais.
All right. So this is a great, exciting thing. The Comedy
Mike
Central
Tyson.
People have pulled together a bunch of people who aren't afraid to say some real edgy things to some people that aren't expecting it in any way. Can it possibly not be boring this year?
I'm shocked by what I remember when I think it was already was telling me when they did the roast for William Shatner.
Yeah.
And his wife had drowned in a pool 3 months earlier. And they said, hey, no drowning. No, that's off limits.
Yeah.
And then everybody's like, ah, fuck. Shit. Like, I was like, what? They actually had jokes ready to go about his fucking newly dead wife? Ah, fuck. Back to the drawing board, you know. But I don't know about the roast. I remember when they started, they had guys like you were talking about, Dick Capri and Freddie Roman and those guys, and it was fun to see them.
Yeah, well, it was their sort of sport. You know, that style of comedy is very, it's set a punchline. But there was also like a ball buster thing to it that it was because they were friends, and now I don't think that you necessarily... Like, not a lot of Charlie Sheen's friends are going to get up and do this.
That's a big problem with
the same group of eight people attacking new meat this year.
Right, that's a big difference between the roasts of the old days and the roasts of now, yeah.
But you did a roast a
what
couple
do you think
years.
The... Yeah, I did one, yeah, one time. But it's hard for me. You did it. It's hard to...
I did it, too. That's what I heard, and I heard that it was really silly. Funny, except that people didn't really get... That you weren't doing straight up.
Some people didn't get it. It was a very simple, very, very simple thing.
Yeah.
But for some people, actually thought I was mentally ill or something like that. But no, because Saget, I like Saget a lot, and he kept pushing me to go and do it, and I didn't know how to do it, you know. So that was just my...
Well, it's not meant for everybody.
Yeah,
not,
if you're not an insult
comic. Sarah Silverman has always said, I can't do it. It's just not what I do. Yeah. And obviously Comedy Central would love her to do it.
Yeah, yeah.
So what were you going to ask me?
About what was I going to ask you?
I don't know.
Where were we?
We're talking about whether roast can be good again, and that there is no friendship underneath it, so it didn't.
Charlie Sheen. No, but also, is there a problem with people that clearly have some sort of issue with whatever he has, mania or whatever that is? You know.
In other words, they think it's making fun of somebody who's handicapped.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't think that's drugs.
They're having trouble booking the dais?
I've heard they are.
Norm and I are available. I'll do it. See, I am a roast comic.
No.
That's the crazy thing.
Yeah.
I love it. Hold on, Mike.
I think they're getting roasters. It's like they're getting the friend. It's the part, you know, the dais is the usual suspects, right, who are there every year. And then friends of the person or people that have worked with them. It's that latter group that they're having trouble booking.
The only one I can think of is that guy he does that Two and a Half Men show with.
John Cryer.
I mean, you either got him or you don't. And short of that, I don't know the second, third, and fourth guy.
Michael Douglas.
Michael Douglas. That's his father.
Or his father.
Yeah.
Or his brother.
Yeah, I don't think anyone cares, really. You know, I mean, to me, Charlie Sheen, he transcends a roast because he went out and he did, like, what we were talking about earlier in terms of, like, you know, whether it was mania or not. The guy still, I think, went after what his aesthetic was, you know, like it or not, or prove it or not. I think the guy was in it and still is in it. So
right.
For you to stand back and roasting to me is holding up a mirror to a guy and so that he has to laugh at himself.
Right.
But Charlie Sheen does.
He's done that himself.
Yeah.
He's Teflon. It's hard to understand how you're going to insult the guy. You know what I mean? He's saying, I'm a warlock. I'm a, you know.
Yeah.
I have tiger in my blood.
Yeah.
You know, and what can you say to that? I mean,
you're little. To take him on, you
like
become
you don't
small.
Get it. Yeah. It's almost like you don't get it.
Yeah.
You know?
And
I couldn't think of a single joke. Like, what are you going to say? This guy's nuts. You know what I mean? I really don't know what would you think if you were trying to write a Charlie Sheen joke, what would the premise of the joke be?
Well, you could talk. The only thing you could do is you could have to step it out to his dad, John Cryer. You'd have to take tangential things in his life and take those on.
Mm-hmm.
You couldn't take on the soul of who the guy is because you're afraid to do what he did. So
yes,
to be a comic who's supposed to be brave,
right?
You know, you look cowardly next
to
him.
Yeah, no, that's very true.
That's why I did Chevy Chase one time.
Oh, yeah. I've seen it.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
It was just horrible because none of his friends showed up.
Right, and he doesn't take it too well.
He sat there with mirrored sunglasses on.
Yeah.
He wouldn't look at us.
I remember that, yeah.
And so the whole crowd was watching him,
yeah.
And he was not liking it, so they weren't liking it, and I was on second to last. And by the time I got up, I had really good jokes written, you know, like I said, this is Chevy Chase's answering machine. I'll take it. And like, you know, like pretty solid, roasty kind of setup.
Yeah.
And so I got up and I think I talked about this before, bombing so badly. Yeah, that was the thing I was talking about. And it didn't even hurt because it just felt ridiculous that we were all up there. Like, here's this guy, Chevy Chase, who's made, you know, a couple of the great, great movies all time. And, you know, whether he's a horse's ass now or not, I haven't done what he did. So who the fuck am I?
It's hard to do that. Yeah, like... I remember one of the first ones was when Jeffrey Ross insulted B. Arthur.
Yeah.
And it was very funny because it was before it was all that, you know.
Because then people knew it was safe.
Yeah.
It's like you said before, what's off limits, this isn't.
And then it was like, whatever, it was a great line, whatever. I wouldn't fuck with B. Arthur's cock. It was just this tangential shot of B. Arthur. And then her face on her look was like, the look on her face was priceless because she was so stunned. She couldn't believe it.
Yeah.
But at the same time, I'm sure she thought, what have you ever done that gives you the, you know, I'm an incredibly funny person. You know, Bea Arthur is like.
I'm a grand. She was actually a feminist. I mean, she came out, you know, doing a television show in the early 1970s that was about a, you know, a woman not taking shit from her husband and going out.
Yeah.
And, you know, she was always the voice in Archie Bunker's wife's head saying like, you don't have to do that. He was showing the changing of a culture, and you're a guy.
And she was being drop dead funny in what must have been the toughest role of like a strident feminist. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But she was funny. Holy God! You know,
funny as shit.
Yeah, it was unbelievable.
All right, we're gonna wrap up the podcast with this. Norm, what are we plugging for you? NormMacDonald.com.
No, don't go.
How about MarkMcGrath.com?
Don't go there. MarkMcGrath.com. That sounds cool. What do I see on the internet? There's a fat girl works over at the 7-Eleven. I think I might. Might take her over to the picture show. Oh, dates.
The picture show.
The bijou.
I like the fact that said, there weren't 7-Elevens yet when you would have taken someone to a picture show.
That's true.
All right, I won't plug anything except I thank you for dropping by my
house. Yeah, this
house
is really fun, man.
In the middle of the night and staying there for a couple
I'll
hours.
Plug your book. It was I really liked it. I really enjoyed
and
it.
And thanks for reading it. You're a part
of it.
Yeah,
it wasn't a bunch of fucking shit.
It wasn't too sentimental, was it?
No, and it wasn't too... well, what do you mean by sentimental? I mean, it wasn't sentimental in the bad
I guess sense. Melodramatic.
Bad way of...
No, melodramatic.
No. It was moving.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. But it wasn't all, oh, hey, look how it wasn't a humorist's work.
I'm going to put that on the back cover of the audio book. Is going to be Norm Macdonald saying it was not a humorist. It was not for me. I'll have the quote because I have it on tape.
I'll say it made David Sedaris look like Russell Baker. Made Russell Brand look like Russell Baker. Made
all right.
David Sedaris look like David Cross.
There we go. That's the one I want to end on. Good night. Thanks for listening. God bless America. Oh, who's that?
Comedy
Quick,
police.
Go get that. Could be somebody scary. I don't know.
Get the knife.
Yeah, Kevin's going to get it. Someone's knocking at Fitzdog Studios at the back door. Kevin, our producer, is going to answer it. Who is it?
It's Norm Macdonald.
Holy shit. Norm Macdonald is now walking into Fitzdog Studios.
Should I get up?
That can't be.
Is that even true?
I don't think I can make that
up. I don't think that's true.
I talked to him earlier today. He knew I was coming here.
Seriously? Hey!
Look at this!
Holy
shit!
Unbelievable!
Let me get up real quick. Hey, Norm.
This is when podcasting really...
Yeah.
How are you, man?
Norm, sit down,
brother. Good to see you.
And Ben Hoffman and Laurie Jo Hoekstra.
How are you? This is incredible. This is, it's heart-stopping podcasting here. I live... Again, when you live in Venice Beach, we once had Natalie Maines on a podcast, and Zach Galifianakis walked in to use my printer. This tops that, because Mark McGrath...
Mark, sit down.
...is sitting here. Norm, have a seat.
No, let Mark sit.
All right, Mark, you sit.
Well,
I'm going to share...
I'm going to share a mic with Norm. How about that?
No, Norm, sit down, please.
We don't even need these.
No. Here's what I would like. Here's what we're going to do on Fitzdog Radio. Norm Macdonald is now going to interview Mark McGrath instead of me, because you know what? I almost feel like you're a better interviewer than an interviewee.
You're out of questions?
And and I'm completely out of questions. By the way, I'm going to be performing at the Cleveland Hilarities, if you could read it. Cleveland Hilarities, October.
What is going on?
No, your intuition about me being a good interviewer is really bad. Ben Hoffman, you want to?
I'll feed you questions.
Ben Hoffman is going to pitch a TV show tomorrow.
No shit.
Yeah, at a Comedy Central.
Not tomorrow.
Or Friday.
Would you give him any warning on that? No, I know it inside and out. Thanks to Norm.
Ben wrote on Sports Show with Norm Macdonald.
Yeah.
Did a great job. So Norm knows him well.
Take your headphones off, dummy. There's nothing to hear.
I just like to hear the ambience, man. It makes me feel good.
We were talking earlier about whether or not anybody can really change their worldview. Because Mark is this guy who, you know, when you meet a nice guy, you like to poke a little bit and find the ugly side because you think the guy's full of shit, right? I do, and I can't find his dark side.
I'm super happy when I meet people like that, to tell you the truth. Like I'm not a cynical person.
That's what amazes me about you, because I think because you're edgy and because you take on people that are probably deserving of a good barb now and again, that maybe you're mean-spirited, but you're actually not.
No, but what's Mark's worldview?
Well, Mark, why don't you answer that?
No, we were saying... My
guess would be like he's a person that seems to be full of goodwill.
And he's super positive, and I was asking if it was always that way, and he said, yeah, and Greg then had the thesis, you're born that way. And I thought... Maybe a lot of people have bottomed out or were negative. Find a way, whether it's a therapist or a book or whatever it is, a bottom, and then they get positive and they start like because this guy is so ridiculously positive in a good way. I'm not making fun of it at all. I'm wondering if he was always that way, because I'm always trying to learn how to be positive, and it's tough, I find.
I kind of told them that, like, I feel like I'm the most fortunate guy in the world. I mean, I overpaid and was fairly successful. Two things I don't do well: sing and host. You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I'm sitting here with a table with you guys.
I
feel like I'm
stronger.
Where's Waldo? I don't really belong here, you know? So I think that just sort of like perpetuates my positivity, if there is any to be had, you know? If that makes any sense.
No, that doesn't make sense.
You don't need to comment either, Norm. I'm just kind
Well, this is what I think. I think, like, this is a thing I came up with. You want to hear it?
Yeah.
Yes.
Everybody has dealt a hand of cards, right? Everybody's dealt their own hand in life. And so then you go, well, can people rise up above their position where they start when they're poor and get rich and get out of a troubled place? And they go, because they're dealt this hand, but also part of the hand you're dealt is being able to overcome adversity. That's also part of the hand you're dealt.
But I think adversity is one thing, but I read once that, say you suffered the loss of a sibling, that you would be depressed. Anybody would obviously be distraught. It's traumatic. But that within a year, these studies they did, there was this Harvard professor, did a lot of actually nuts and bolts. These were, you know, scientific studies of brain levels that they can chart now. And they found that people with a positive disposition return to it no matter what adversity they've been through. People that hit the lottery but were always sort of cynical, they go back to that within a year. So that it may not be a matter that you can dig into, like financially, your well-being, as much as something that you struggle with but can only, I don't know, maybe there's a little bit of sway but not a fundamental change.
But I don't think, like, I see people on TV and shit, right? And they're like, you never, like, when your child dies, you never get over it. It's always the same. Every day you fucking think about it. Not a fucking hour passes. And I'm like, horse shit. You know? And then you see the guy interviewed for the rest of the thing. He's laughing.
Yeah.
I swear I seen Paul Newman do that once on Larry King. He's like, you think about it all the time. Then he's laughing, telling a story about some other shit.
Yeah, yeah.
Of course you don't think about it all the time, or you'd put a gun in your head.
Right. Right?
Could you read this?
Oh, yeah. Oh, your stand-up. Yeah, you're going to be at the Chicago Improv. They have an improv in Chicago?
No.
I go to that fucking Zany's. Holds 50 people.
Oh,
I know. And then they go, it's an institution. You go, what? No one can hear you. It's like horrible. Yeah, I know. Right. You go, what am I, a fucking historian? I'm Mark Maron all of a sudden? I'm just trying to make a living. Pittsburgh, the improv in Pittsburgh, that's a good gig.
Yeah.
And your September, your stand-up live, where was that?
In Phoenix.
Oh, I did that. Oh, fuck yeah.
Huh?
Well, here's the thing. Did you used to do Tempe?
Yes.
Yeah, well, they convinced me to change from Tempe to Stand Up Live.
Yeah.
But Tempe was the best room in the country.
It was the best room in the country, but I guess now they book it like corporate. They want everybody to be clean.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Is that Spade's territory? The Tempe one? Does he do that a lot?
The last time I did Tempe, Spade flew in on a private jet.
Really?
It was me and Artie Lang at the Tempe Improv, and Spade, and Artie goes, we're out to dinner. He goes, Spade might be coming out. I go, well, why is he in town? He's going to be in about 5 minutes. He fucking shows up in a jet, watches the show. We go out for a drink, and then he flies home.
One time this limo driver's driving me, right? And he's like, I got to tell you right off the bat, I'm a character.
He has to tell you?
Yeah, I'm like, you can't say it yourself.
It's on his card in quotes underneath his name.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. No, that's like the guy who you hear go, but you know me.
Yeah.
Yeah. Of course.
Right.
Naturally, you're a character.
My favorite is like when a guy just, he's a motherfucker, and then, but is that people just say his name, and that excuses everything. That's Sam.
That's Sam.
Yeah.
You're like, what? The guy's fucking mean and shit.
Yeah.
Hey, you got no Sam.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
He's a mean guy.
That's OJ.
He's just Sam-ing you. Oh, you got Sam.
Well, I guess maybe that was Josh. Maybe Josh was a liar, you know? And he became a verb. He's joshing you. He's lying to you.
Oh, yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Dick.
Actually, it came from Josh Billings, the American humorist, but it's a good theory.
You know what would be the worst insult?
That should be sponsored.
A little factoid. Like,
yeah, I know.
If you talk about the lowest thing in comedy, it's being called a humorist, by the way.
It is, right?
It is the worst thing to be called.
Well, you know, like, what do you think of the
Dave
author,
Barry?
David Sedaris.
I love David Sedaris.
Is Andy Rooney a humorist?
Yes.
Got it. You'd be right.
I think they're very often self-named.
But, you know, I remember reading an article in Spy one time. Remember that magazine from a little time ago?
Separated they had at birth.
Seinfeld, they had Seinfeld quotes and Andy Rooney quotes all in the, mixed up, but you couldn't tell.
That's funny.
It's pretty interesting.
Wow.
Yeah. No, I actually love... I'm not saying I dislike Andy Rooney. I'm saying that personally, if I were called a humorist, I would take it as an insult because it has a soft... connotation to it.
It's an old school term, isn't it? They're like humorous. You know, no, it's people.
It's academic.
Out to be humorous.
It's kind of. Yeah. It means
their
that
thoughts.
Yeah, it's like being called a thespian instead of a good actor.
I picture a bow tie.
And if you got to write a big long fucking thing in the newspaper, hundreds of words a day and shit, it's not going to be too good. But because when I was a kid, it was Art Buchwald.
I love Art Buchwald.
Yeah, But I didn't understand it that much.
I like political comedy. I just liked.
But it was very like one idea stretched out. Right? I guess it was a satire or something, right? I didn't understand a fucking word of it.
My dad liked him, and I used to read the craziest shit because my parents would anything that had comedy in it when I was a kid. I was into, and like I just knew that Art Buchwald. And so I met him once with your buddy Jack Stout.
Oh, really?
He had a buddy who lived on the vineyard that I sponged onto and became friends with. And I'm standing on the beach one night, and Art Buchwald standing there. He dresses like a fucking lunatic. You know, he's got silly hat and the silly, you know, everything's buttoned wrong on purpose. and he was funny as shit. He was like cursing about the Kennedys and they were standing right down the beach. It was like this very she part of Martha's Vineyard. And I just remember reading all these shitty books like Irma Bombeck. She was a humorist.
She was a humorist, Irma Bombeck. Her book was called The Grass is Always Greener on Top of a Septic Tank.
That's right. Or the other one was, If Life is a Bowl of Cherries, Why Am I Always in the Pits?
Yes. Oh, yeah.
That was another one.
These are like things you knit on pillows.
Yes. Yeah. I wonder, I guess because when you wake up, like, you want to just laugh.
Well, who's a young humorist today? Excuse me, Mike.
I thought it was David Sedaris.
Oh, Sedaris. Oh, okay.
Who I don't know at all.
I don't either.
But you like him.
I enjoy him quite a bit.
Yeah. So you like humorists.
What about Louis Black?
He's a political satirist.
He's angry.
Is he a little bit on the cusp of a humorist at all?
Oh, man. That guy's angry.
Hey, he is, man. That's all I got.
What does it take to tee him off?
Anything. This is the problem. These guys that are angry, they get fucking caught in a corner because there's only so much shit you can get angry about. So then I'm watching, you see Dennis Leary or something. He's like, fucking croissants. I don't want a fucking croissant. You're like, okay, that's all right. Why can't you just call it a donut? I don't know. It's not really a donut.
Because it's a different version of that.
But yeah, you know, when you're right, you gotta go to that point of view. But he's a lot of spit comes out of him, Louis Black. But he's a political, I don't know if he's a satirist, really.
Well, I think when it's politics, people default to satirist for some reason.
Yeah, yeah.
Whereas satire, I think, technically means that you're taking something on, but you're going to the core of it.
Yeah, you're saying the truth. You're something extra. It's really bad. I remember at Saturday Night Live, Jim Downey, he would describe Janine Garofalo. He'd go, how did she become an expert on comedy? Because where the fuck's her jokes? You know, like don't you have to have one quotable joke in your life? You know, and then he said in his generation, or Janine Garofalo in his generation was Alan King. He just fucking. Bunch of all this shit, but he'd talk about comedy.
Yes.
He'd have, you know, shows about comedy.
And he had a series Inside the Comedy Mind.
Did
on
he
HBO,
really?
Where, yeah, he would sit on a stool, and then he'd make like a Jerry Seinfeld type of an individual sit on the other stool.
Yeah.
And then he wouldn't say like this, like, hey, let's riff and just see what happens. He would go, now...
What's funny?
When I was coming up, we dressed up for a show. You kids don't. And then he just let it hang in the air, and then Seinfeld would have to respond on some level.
I went when I was in New York. I was a fucking gambling. I was a gambling addict and shit. I always wanted a game of something, kind of could find a game to lose money on and shit, right? So they go, there's a poker game at the Friars Club. I didn't even know what the Friars Club is. Yeah. I didn't even know what it was. That's how stupid I am about comedy. So I go there. It's all old fucking guys playing poker and shit, right? But no big stars. It's like Freddie Roman. Like a real sub-level guy. I didn't even know these guys. But they were all old and shit. And I'm like, I've slept. I've been playing all these card games in New York. And I get to the Friars Club. And they're not playing for much money. But I just want to play. Anyways, I notice, like in my haze, like I notice these old guys keep calling me a fag. But it doesn't register right away, but because I'm trying to concentrate. But then finally I hear a guy go, here's a queen for the queen. You know? I'm like, what? I'm not queen, what? So then some old guy next to me is like, he's like, kid. So he takes me in the back. I'm like, what? He's like, you got to give it back as good as they give it. You know? I go, what? He goes, that's the only way they'll respect you. So I'm like, oh, fuck, you know? So then I go back, we're playing for a while, I call an old man a fag, he gets mad at me. It was so ugly. It was terrible. I didn't want to do it.
And they're playing for like a nickel.
Yeah, they're playing for nothing. Yeah. And so he got hilarious. Sad. He probably was secretly gay or something. I probably picked the one guy that was secretly. Yeah.
Well, that's the thing is, I remember I did one of those roasts, like the real Friars ones, not the Comedy Central ones.
Yeah, yeah.
And I mean, I just swallowed mouthfuls of my own vomit. I just died. And then afterwards, Freddie Roman said in a newspaper article about how some of the comedians did poorly and they really need to take a class on comedy from some of the from the other guys. And I felt bad because, like, Freddie. I grew up respecting these guys. Like, Freddie Roman,
you
like,
knew him?
I really, oh, yeah, he was my sponsor.
Because you're from the East Coast.
Yeah, I.
Sponsoring booze? What?
No.
Comedy sponsor?
Yeah, he pays for this podcast. He sponsors it. No, I joined the Friars Club, and he was my sponsor.
Oh, I got you. Yeah, he was a good friend of my dad's. Yeah.
So I grew up watching these guys. The
Wait, was your dad a comic?
My dad was a big radio guy in New York.
Oh, awesome.
Yeah, he was the scribe of the Friars Club.
Oh. Was he a friend of Herb Schreiner?
Yes, old he
Herb
was, Schreiner? Matter of fact.
That's pretty cool.
Even the names are old school.
My dad said you were a fag. But it was hard getting critiqued by those guys because I really do look up to them still. I still think that they're like the real journeymen because there was no TV for them. They really did it like just for the love of the game.
Right, 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 right.
You know,
like one time I was in a writing room and there was an old guy there. He was his name was Jerry Belson, but he was a writer and he was like, oh, these new writers, they fucking come from Harvard and shit. They want to be writers their whole life. But he was 60 or 70 or something. He said, not me, man. When I started, everybody thought I was fucking crazy. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like to be a comedy writer, you know?
Well, they were gag writers at first.
Gag writers, yeah.
They had like no money and they'd write a couple bits for...
just stand out in the hall. That's where kids in the hall got their names. You know that?
Is that true?
Because Benny had Benny would say, oh, we don't have good enough jokes. Go see what the kids in the hall got. And then there was the gag writers out in the hallway. Oh.
Huh.
I give you that packet, that Woody Allen packet.
That where was awesome.
Yeah, he wrote these jokes. For Herb Schreiner.
No shit.
And it was all these bits, and some were for in character, and then it was like, here's some other ones I wrote on my own, and it was a packet like Woody Allen. It was weird seeing him like trying to win someone's approval, which he hasn't done almost ever, I think, like in his work in a way.
Well, I like Mark's outlook on life.
Yeah, let's get back to that.
Give him
because this is fascinating.
Because I find the same way, like people, because people always expect me to be angry when I lose something, and I go, "What the? How the fuck? It's so lucky to be here in the first place." You know, I mean, if you were Orson Welles or some shit, you'd be bitter. Didn't even seem that bitter. You know what I mean? Like
totally.
Like those guys, you could see. And then when you read in Hollywood, fucking Fitzgerald came here. You know what I mean? Actual novelists came here and got treated like shit by the studios. You know what I mean? And then you go, what do I got to complain about?
Yeah, but I think you could say that about anybody. I mean, you can always find someone shittier than you. Like for me, I always feel like when things are really bad, you got to go to like the third world to make you fall. What am I complaining about? You know, like that's one of my tweets. Got to be coming up in the future. It's like, well, at least I'm not sucking a dick for a, you know, a soda can.
That's the third world. I didn't have that image.
Oh yeah, well they'll do anything. But the but your personality is really like people think of you as a deviant and you have addiction issues and all that stuff.
Wait, so, what?
But would that be? But people would say that you're like self medicating or you're escaping with gambling and all
like
that stuff.
People would say.
All right, I'm saying it. I would say, all right, let me say it. You're right.
Yeah,
that was bullshit.
Yeah.
You have a gambling problem.
I did, yeah.
And you have substance abuse issues.
I don't have substance abuse issues.
Do you want a beer?
No, I don't drink.
He doesn't drink.
Oh, that's right.
I actually don't drink so like strictly that people think I'm an alcoholic.
Oh, no shit.
It's just an odd paradigm, you know.
It's like somebody thinks you're married just because you never get laid.
Somebody thinks you're what?
Married. Because you never get laid?
Yeah.
That'd be like a humorist. So,
with alcohol especially, I guess because it's so prevalent. But obviously, if you said, I don't smoke weed or I don't do cocaine, people wouldn't think you had a problem with it. But if you rigidly don't drink alcohol...
Yeah,
and they usually think you're an alcoholic.
My friend was the same way. He started just carrying wine around. He didn't even drink that, just so people wouldn't, you know, just think he had a problem. Because that's
yeah.
You're entirely correct.
You know what I used to do? Because I don't drink, I go to bars. And maybe I told you this. I probably told you this. I just pretend to be drunk to get girls, because I noticed I'd be talking to girls, and fucking they'd all be like, what are you? But then a drunk guy would be pawing them.
Right.
And shit. So I said, fuck it, I'll just act drunk.
Yeah.
So I'd say inappropriate things, paw at them, and they just giggle.
Oh, yeah, yeah. It was like Paul Newman in The Hustler when he, not The Hustler, The Sting. Yep. When he would pretend, he pretended to get drunk on that train ride so that he could throw those guys
plays,
in the card game.
Yeah. Yeah,
it's played, a skill.
That was a great scene.
You got to look wounded. You got to look vulnerable.
He acted drunk in The Hustler, too.
Yeah,
in the first
scene. I never put that together.
Yeah.
He's done it twice.
He's a great acting drunk guy.
Yeah.
He in The Verdict. Yeah, I mean, he's great. He plays a drunk really, really good because he plays a drunk trying to keep it together. You know,
Days of Wine and Roses.
Well, that was Jack Lemmon. But
Jack
Lemmon.
I'm sorry, your name again? I get confused.
You know what was cool about Days of Wine and Roses? I didn't even see it coming because I never heard about the movie. For the first half of the movie, it's like a romantic comedy.
Yeah.
It's like all sweet, and then it all goes to hell. It's
like
brilliant.
Which part is the comedy where you've got the crippled, limping woman at the beginning? Who's...
No, you're thinking of a different movie.
No, Days of Wine and Roses. She had a limp. She had a sad limp.
You're talking about The Hustler.
Nope.
What's he talking about, Mike?
Days of Wine and Roses. What's the woman's name? Who
Piper
was
Laurie?
Was it animated?
No.
The one you're thinking of?
Keep going.
You might
keep interviewing Mark McGrath.
Are you thinking of the other? Are you thinking of Lost Weekend or something?
Maybe I'm thinking of Lost Weekend.
Yeah, Days of Wine and Roses. Jack Lemmon and somebody, Piper Laurie, something like that, and they're all happy and everything's a lark. And then halfway through the movie, it all goes to hell.
Hmm. Because of drinking.
Then he quits. He gets her drinking. Then he quits. And then she ends up sucking off dudes in a hotel.
For money?
Yeah. And that's the end of the movie. Like, he's in AA. Maybe it was one of the first AA movies around. And he goes to her and he goes, come on. She's like, get away, you know?
Yeah.
So he's destroyed this other person's life with his...
So it ends poorly, too? I haven't seen it.
Yeah,
so there's no Hollywood wrap-up?
No.
That was probably one of the first movies like that, too.
Probably. Yeah, probably.
Okay. I'm glad I came to insert that.
Well, I mean...
Now even the Bad News Bears have to win. I mean, like, now literally, I think no one has the balls to make an unhappy movie. I don't know. If they do, it's only once in a while.
Did the Bad News Bears win it?
When they remade it. They remade it. They would not allow them to lose. Like, it just didn't make sense.
Really?
And that's the whole heart
of it. That's the whole movie.
I know, the whole thing.
That's why you don't remake that movie, man.
I know.
Come on. Yeah.
But also, like, if you think about it, if you look at the top 10 best movies of all time, even Casablanca, all of them, they're usually not happy endings.
No.
They're like it's not even bittersweet, but sometimes it's just like a great sad ending, you know?
Well, a lot of times you get the screeners, you know, from the academies when the Oscars are coming up.
Yeah.
And those movies, which are the best ones, all have very sad endings. But then the ones that do the big box office are always the ones that, you know, what was the one that you were in with Kevin James and Chris Rock?
Mall Cop?
You're talking
where Kevin swung a rope into a tree?
Oh, yeah. I wasn't actually in it.
No, you were in it. You were naked.
No, that was a double.
No, it wasn't.
Yeah, my stunt double made it in.
No shit. That's all they kept of you?
Yeah.
Really? I didn't know that.
Wait a minute. So you spent like a week filming stuff?
I spent
stuff?
2 months. And I kept telling them they're going to cut it out of the movie. Because this was my character in the movie. It was a guy who showed up, like, because it was about a movie about all these guys that went back to their hometown, right? Yeah. So I was the guy that never left my hometown. So I would show up and go, hey, guys, what are you doing? You know? And they go, oh, we got to do, you know, hey, can I be part of it? But no, no. So then I was like, that's my every scene. I go, geez, that seems pretty cuttable. I'm virtually a guy showing up wanting to be in the movie. And they're like, no, no, it's funny. I go, yeah, I don't know.
Why do I think I saw you in that movie?
Well, my for one moment, my stunt double goes down a slide and then has his big hairy ass. I've been in two movies where I refused to do it, and then they got a guy with a big hairy ass.
And he's the only thing that stays in the movie. That's great.
Why is that so funny?
You know who else that happened to? Was Jon Stewart was in... Wives Club. It was First Wives Club, was a fucking big movie.
Yeah.
And it was like, you know, he was at that crossroads where he was a stand-up and getting a little bit of hosting gigs. And then this was going to be his movie career, you know? And he ended up every single... And I mean, same thing, like a month filming it, everything on the cutting room floor. And he went, I'm fucking going on TV. I can't... The movies.
Man. I remember that. He had like a deal with Harvey Weinstein and stuff. He was going to be in movies.
Yeah.
And shit. I think he had one movie or something.
I was going to ask Mark.
How many movies have you been in, Mark? 12? Like 12?
No. We played ourselves in Scooby-Doo. Thanks for asking. And
oh, really?
Yeah.
Scooby-Doo, that's cool.
It was very quick. Dude, it's... There's no movies. I'm stoked to hear you talk, Norm. I'm a big fan. And I have the best seat in the house, dude. So I'm not gonna bring this to a screeching halt and talk about my life.
I want to see Scooby-Doo.
Make sure you go see that one.
But you know what? You ever see this? Is what happened to me because of the computer and shit. I saw Winnie the Pooh. You know, because I like fucking cartoons a lot. So I went to see Winnie. They have a new Winnie the Pooh. So I'm like, and I loved it. I thought, fuck, this movie's fucking great. Then a guy sends me a link. I think I'm a retard. I like Winnie the Pooh. And a guy sends me a link to this review that said it's a postmodern classic. So I'm like, oh, maybe I liked it for like some reason that I didn't know.
I saw Shrek 4, and it was about his midlife crisis.
Yeah.
And it profoundly affected my midlife crisis and helped me get out of it.
Oh, really?
Really?
Yeah. He was like an ogre who longer scared people, and he sort of like made it, and he had some money, and he didn't have his edge anymore, and he was like had two kids. And
I love stuff like that.
I mean, some of those movies are I was talking
about postmodern, because I don't know what that means.
Postmodern means that it was modern.
Yeah.
And then
you don't know what it means. Right?
No.
I don't know what it means either.
We were in a movie once with Ivan Reitman directing, with Billy Crystal and Robin Williams, a remake of a French movie that was huge called Father's Day. Okay, now Ivan Reitman directing, Billy Crystal and Robin Williams for the first time in a movie, and you know, starring our band in 95.
Wow.
We were nothing. And we thought it was going to be the biggest fucking thing ever. We were so excited. Opened to 12 million, drifted away. You see it on like Showtime every now and then. That's my story. I'm going to take a pee.
No, it's amazing how you see movies.
Really
going. He's
committing. He's actually going into the
building.
Bathroom.
He left the building.
It is amazing when you see movies on HBO, like the biggest. You never even heard of the movie.
And they have
and
the big,
the biggest stars in the world. You go, how on earth did this movie never open?
Never went to the theater, right?
Well,
how's that work with movies?
How would I test
it or something, and then it doesn't work out?
People lose faith early in movies, I think, sometimes.
Well, I think even before it comes out, sometimes you're already fucked because, you know, say it is a Harvey Weinstein movie, and then he's got another movie, and he's got to sort of pick one to be his fall release because, you know, the Christmas release is where you – and so there's all this politics that by the time – I mean, you experience this with your show on Comedy Central. There's so many elements that can go into the success or the pickup of a show that have nothing to do with how good it is, Or yeah. even sometimes how many people are watching it. It has to do with what the sponsor's like. Or is there a show coming after it that they'd rather set up with another show? Or how would yeah. you describe...
I guess you're right.
Well, when you think about your show, which I got to honestly say, people say, well, you know, it was just sports. So how many people are watching sports? And I said, yeah, but how many shows have Norm Macdonald just telling jokes for half an hour? Like, it just doesn't get... And I'm not blowing smoke up your ass. This is what I genuinely say is, like, I could watch you sit and tell jokes for half an hour. I don't give a fuck what it's about. And I never felt like it excluded people yeah. from watching it. So what do you think, looking back on it, would they say is the reason why it was canceled?
I don't know what they would say, but I would say the reason is that has sports in the title. So no lady would ever turn it on. That's what I would think, personally. Like, I go, why would a lady turn a show on that says sports?
Yeah.
So then you cut half your audience. Then you're kind of dead if you're only going after half.
I guess so.
I don't know. That's all I can figure.
Yeah. Well, it was a goddamn shame. And I think they lack balls and not picking it up for second season.
They go through a lot of shows, though, man.
Yeah. And the ones they do pick up, they...
Like, I was talking to Dimitri Martin. I thought his show lasted a long time. He told me only lasted two seasons.
Yeah, because they took a year and a half off between seasons.
Right, right.
And like Sarah Silverman's show.
Oh, right, right.
They shot the pilot, and then it sat on the shelf for 9 months, and all of a sudden Herzog went, hey, where's that Sarah Silverman pilot?
Really?
And the executives went, oh, no, it didn't test well. And they go, can I take a look at it? And he goes, put this fucking show on the air. And it was a big hit, and then it took them 9 months to order a second season. Wow. So by the time you're a Sarah Silverman fan, all of a sudden you're like, forgot what the goddamn show was.
Right, right, right. Of course, yeah.
So they got a new regime over there at Comedy Central, and that Alterman is a really talented guy.
He's a great guy. No,
he's a great guy. I think part of it is what you just said. I think they are, and I worked on the show with Norm, they are, and Lori Jo did too, who's here. They and Ben, they...
Jesus Christ, Mike.
They are...
You want to give the fucking drips and the gaffers credits?
Also, audible.com is a sponsor, is that
yes.
right?
So get a free one if you go to audiblepodcast.com/Greg.
It's a great pod commercial, by the way. I listen every week. I think it's a new regime. I think there's a lot of change, and I think they're trying to find...
By the way, you know TV
identity.
Is evil when it's a regime.
It was a coup. But and also, you know, they're picking up a lot of shows that figured into their decision, which is they're searching for their identity, I think. And that's not slamming them. I just think that's what happens. You know, they're trying to change, I think, a bit.
So what's the...
And a lot of shows got lost in that shuffle.
All right. So, Norm, you're a producer, writer. You've got Mark McGrath. You know that he's interested.